got crash here.
The guy's just slamming guys for no reason.
And everybody's driving 20 feet over their heads.
So hopefully Ryan makes a bunch more wrecks.
All anybody can save is Talladega.
Mostly sunny, breezy, cool day here in Kansas City. Temperature might finally make it to 70 this afternoon. That'll warm up the fans here at the track. Cars sitting on pit road, still warming up, getting ready to make their pace laps, and here they come now. Budweiser, the official beer of NASCAR, is the proud sponsor of the Budweiser Pole Award, given to the fastest qualifier at each NASCAR NEXTEL Cup Series race. Budweiser congratulates Matt Kenseth, his second pole of the season. We'll see Matt and the rest of the guys in the Bud Shootout at Daytona in February. Cars heading out on the track. Here's the Harley-Davidson starting lineup. Matt's on the pole, one at Bristol, then Elliott Sadler right next door.
Jeff Gordon on the inside of row two. Great qualifying effort. And Scott Wimmer, how about that on the outside of row two?
Good qualifying for Kevin LePage and outside of row three and Carl Edwards.
Denny Hamlin qualified 11th, but he'll go to the back of the field. He crashed on the second qualifying lap. Greg Biffle, one of the guys in the chase for the NEXTEL Cup.
Row five, we might find the winner here. Tony Stewart on the inside, Kurt Busch on the outside.
Row six, inside, Ryan Newman. And on the outside, another good run, Jeff Green.
Sterling Marlin starts 13th. He's right next to Jeremy Mayfield, another driver in the chase.
Back in row eight, on the inside is Mike Wallace. On the outside, last year's winner, Joe Nemechek.
Brian Vicker on the outside, inside of row nine, and Brandon Ash, rookie, on the outside.
Mark Martin, he's in the chase, looking for better things, coming off the disappointment at Talladega, shares row 10 with Kevin Harvick.
Row 11, we found a couple of Rick Henry cars. Kyle Busch on the inside, Jimmy Johnson on the outside.
Row 12, we find Ken Schrader and Kyle Petty.
In row 13, Bobby Hamilton Jr. and Dave Blaney in the 07 ride.
Row 14, P.J. Jones on the inside. Impressive qualifying run by him and Mike Bliss on the outside.
Row 15, last year, Ricky Rudd finished second here. And on the outside, Jamie McMurray.
Row 16, last week's winner, Dale Jarrett, and the set heads are here. Boris Said back there in 32nd today.
Row 17 on the inside, Rusty Wallace. Car not handling well qualifying, but he's going to be okay today, he said. Casey Mears on the outside.
Row 18, Michael Waltrip on the outside, and the inside is Terry Labonte.
Back in row 19, Travis Quaffle and Dale Earnhardt Jr. has the 38th starting spot.
Row 20, Bobby Labonte on the inside and Jeff Burton on the outside. Two good drivers.
Row 21, Scott Riggs went for a wild ride last week at Talladega, and Case Kane never even got the green on his qualifying run, so he's starting in a backup.
And the 43rd starter, Stuart Kirby. Take a look at the guys that didn't make the race. And Kane, Hamlin, and Ryan Newman to the back of the field. Newman for work on the transmission. Benny, you got a radio over there?
Yeah, we're going to try to talk to Carl Edwards. Hey, Carl, this is Benny Parsons. You got me?
Loud and clear, Benny. How you doing today?
Man, I'm doing great for a Missouri boy. This is a home team. Got anything for him today?
I think we do. Bob Osborne and all the guys back at the shop built a great, awesome race car here. And, man, I'm pumped to go racing. I'd love to win at this racetrack.
Carl, good luck to you. Thanks.
Thanks, Benny.
Final stories from pit road. Let's start with Dave Burns.
Bill, just a few moments ago, you guys talked about the 1.5 mile cookie-cutter racetracks. Does Greg Biffle like him? Well, he sure does in 2005. Average finish, 5.4 with a win at Texas. And yesterday, right here at Kansas, a dominating performance in the Busch race after he gave way to Casey Kane on the final lap. Good information for Biffle. He likes the 1.5 mile tracks. Marty?
Well, Dave, talk about momentum. Tony Stewart certainly has it. Our championship leader since Father's Day weekend has only finished out of the top 10 once. That was at Dover a couple of weeks ago, and he loves this type of racetrack, and he has his favorite car, the one that won Indianapolis. Their plan today, same plan as all of the chase races. In the first three chase races, Tony has scored more bonus points than anyone, leading the most laps in the first and third race. Same plan for this afternoon, Matt.
Marty Stewart was the first Indiana-born driver to win a NASCAR NEXTEL Cup Series title. Ryan Newman would like to be number two. It took Stewart to race number 30 in 2002 to ever lead the points. Newman's never led the points. He hopes to do so today in race number 30. Now he has three top five finishes in the chase, the only driver to do so. He's won here before, but he has to start deep in the field. He can't have a repeat of last year, which was his worst finish in the chase, 33rd. AB?
Well, Matt, Jimmy Johnson lost the championship lead after the crash at Talladega. How do you put a bad day behind you? You start the next race. Jimmy's crew chief, Chad Knaus, just told his entire team on the radio, this day is all about keeping our car up front, having no problems, and getting a good finish. It's all about those two words today for the 48 team, good finish. Bill?
Thank you, Alan. You gentlemen have a great day down there. For much more on NASCAR, log on to NBCSports.com. Benny has a preview of each race in the chase for the NEXTEL Cup Championship. And Alan looks at why Ryan Newman could be this year's NEXTEL Cup champion. All that and more at NBCSports.com. Fayold coming to get the green. 267 laps, 400 miles, and the Banquet 400 for the NASCAR NEXTEL Cup Series today. Seventh race in the chase.
On board with Casey Kane. Jeff Burton also has an onboard camera. Michael Walter allows us to ride along with him as he tries to win this race.
Bobby Labonte. Got a lot of in-car cameras today.
We gotta move that. Okay, there we go. And Kyle Busch. A different sponsorship this week.
Ricky Rudd, 21 car.
All right, boys, get ready. Junior, get ready. We're about to go.
More than 80,000 here to watch the Banquet 400. The green flag is out on NBC.
Groove come in right away, so I don't think that's going to be an issue today. These guys are already up on the house high side, especially in the middle to the back of the pack right now.
Pole sitter Matt Kenseth leads the first lap and five bonus points for Matt. Tony Stewart in the 20, championship leader.
Mike Wallace at four car, terrific run for him, as well as Jeff Green at 43. Vickers. Vickers on the inside of Jeff Green in the 25.
Matt made sure he got his five bonus points on the start. Now Jeff Gordon begins to ride his bumper. Gordon, a two-time winner at this track, and you know his team would really like to perform well here.
Every one of those team members on that 24 car right now, Bill, just sit in there. Please, car, stay this way for 400 miles. They have really struggled on these racetracks.
First report from pit road. Here's Alan.
Now, about the leader, Matt Kenseth, Bill, you were talking about getting those five bonus points. When I talked with his crew chief, Robbie Reiser, this morning about their approach to the race, he said, no magic formula. Race as hard as we can all day, get every position we can all day, and try to win. Matt?
Alan, confidence is high here at the 24 pit. They know they've got a good car for today, but they're looking ahead to Homestead, Atlanta, a few other tracks later in the season where they've rebuilt some of the cars, new bodies, but this is a good place to start it, a good season run to gain some momentum for 2006. Right now, the car is very strong.
Yeah, those guys aren't, 24 guys aren't worried about points or who's wearing points or that's not their concern today. They just want to win races between now and the end of the season.
Most of them are worried about their jobs because, you know, this car has got to run better.
I talked to Jeff Gordon in the garage over the weekend, and he said, you know, if we win, like, say, here or at Martinsville, but we run outside the top 20 in the other races, I won't be happy. But if we have consistent runs in the top 10 or so, he'll be happy, and he will have a good foundation for next year.
And that's what they're trying to do, is build that foundation for 2006.
Tony Stewart, Sterling Marlin behind him. Dropping back in the field, looking for some guys moving forward, like maybe Rusty Wallace in the two, started 33rd last time by, up to 24th.
Yeah, Russ has been passing a lot of cars just in six or seven laps here.
Go ahead.
He got boxed in up there. It looked like he had a problem there for a moment, but he regrouped, and it looks like he's going, Marty.
Yeah, moving to the front wall, and he talked to me before we got in the car, before he got in the car, and he said, you know, I'm not too worried about starting in the back. He had to start 33rd, as you guys just said. He has a long way to go. He said the car was so loose in qualifying, kind of surprised me, but I think that's how we'll have to be in race trim today. Start the car very loose, meaning it turns a little too easily. By the end of the run on old tires, the car should be much, much better, but he's still moving up through the field, isn't he?
Well, the car is working really good, because he got right up on behind the 07 car, Dave Blaney, and then for him to do that, he can get up right on the bumper and make that car loose, and you can see that Blaney had to move up the racetrack. So if the two car can do that all day, he's going to pass a lot of race cars.
The drivers in yellow on the ticker at the top of your screen are the 10 men in the chase for the NEXTEL Cup. 45 is Kyle Petty.
As we go on back in the field, I've been kind of keeping my eye on Ryan Newman, because I expected him just to march to the front. We usually see that 12 car going to the front, but so far, man, he seemed to be struggling.
BP, they had a lot of concern coming into today's race. The car was tight most of practice. They never had a chance to make a qualifying run because they were struggling so much. The car was tight. It is tight today. He's mired back in traffic, and that's the one thing this team had a major concern about, because the Busch race told them it is so tough to pass here, and track position is everything. They're in the back, but let's go back up to the front for a fourth place battle.
And we're all over it, Matt. Scott Wimmer and Greg Biffle in the 16.
Biffle,
one of the contenders for the NEXTEL Cup.
Yeah, last couple laps, Greg Biffle's been the fastest car on the racetrack. Davey's pretty quick right now.
Yeah, and Matt talked about the 2014 rebuilding cars. This car was the car that Greg tested for the Charlotte race a couple weeks ago and destroyed. Greg had two wrecks there. This was the car that he wrecked really, really bad. They took it back to the shop, spent until 2 a.m. looking it over, and then when the guys came in at 6 a.m. for the regular shift, they determined they could rebuild him. So they did. It is Greg's favorite race car. They brought it here. I think they're going to want to race it one or two more times.
Just like the TV show, huh, Dave?
Absolutely.
Kurt Busch, the reigning series champion, 10th in the chase for the NEXTEL Cup.
And Elliott Sadler, that 38 car, taking a look on the inside of Jeff Gordon.
For second. Allen.
Could be interesting to see how this day goes for this team, Bill, because this is a brand new car from Robert Gates Racing that Robert himself has shepherded the development of over this summer. An extensive review of every area of the Yates Racing chassis program, bodies, chassis parts and pieces. Robert's been the guy over the top of it. They think this car is going to be really good all day.
Man, the engine man working on the car.
Matt Kenseth from the pole has led every lap, but there are a lot more to go. The NASCAR NEXTEL Cup Series live from Kansas on NBC. Caution has just come out here at the Kansas Speedway for Brandon Ashe, and he is not the only car involved. A few others got a piece of this. Happened over in turn two. Here it is. This is just moments ago.
I think everybody pretty much got slowed down, Bill. I don't know if there was even really much contact when looks like Junior got up into Brandon, but then they all pile in here.
And Jarrett, what a great job he does. Look at Ryan Newman.
Yeah,
just
make contact
with that left front fender.
Ryan Newman, fourth in the chase for the NEXTEL Cup. Up against the wall. On board with Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Inside, 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 inside. clear low, inside. Okay, clear.
I'll tell you what, that could have been a huge crash, easily.
Junior slid up the racetrack, it looked like, and
got into Brandon.
First lap of green after the restart. Matt Kenseth, after taking just two tires, leads. Elliott Sadler also a two-tire stop in second. Mark Martin wants the position.
I think he's going to get that position.
I'll tell you what, Mark is getting aggressive after that second spot. He wants it and wants it badly.
And he wants to get past Kenseth, his teammate, and get those five bonus points as well.
Now Biffle, the 16 car, looking on the inside of Elliott Sadler, and Jeff Gordon right behind him.
Ryan Newman is currently back in the 37th position after getting banged up in that crash by Brandon Ash. Rusty Wallace was... Rusty Wallace was moving forward, but he restarts 35th after trouble on his pit stop, and we'll get to that in a moment.
Looks like in that restart, Sadler's car just slid up the racetrack in four, and you know, he only took two tires, but slid up the racetrack in four, and he can't get back down the bottom. He's lost some spots because of it.
These guys seeing how those two tires are going to work early in the race.
On board with Casey Kane.
That's a good time to try to get away with it. Like I said, he only had 17 laps on their tires anyway. That's not many laps on the left side. But four tires yesterday in the Busch race was definitely the way to go. But Casey Kane had track position.
Right. We had a green-white checkered, and Casey held him off.
Ryan Newman is currently running in the 35th position. Matt, how bad was the car torn up?
BP, a lot of cosmetic damage, but especially on that left front corner. In fact, Matt Borland told Ryan, you may have a left front tire smoking because of the way the fender is now contoured due to that crash. Second straight year at Kansas, he has been involved in a crash. Last year, he finished 33rd. He came in today only 4 points out of first. They really have a long day ahead, BP.
Yes, they do, Matt. Oh, here we go now. Scott Wimmer, that 22 car, said, I'm going to pass a couple of those Hendrick cars. Watch me.
Yeah, you can't go three wide. This is exactly what Jimmy Johnson needed to do. He needed to drop off the throttle, let those guys go. You can't go three wide into these corners here in Kansas. Too fast. Board Michael Walton's car. You're 190 plus miles per hour going into these corners here. And very, very fast. How's Michael doing there, Dave?
He's doing pretty well, Wally, and he wanted to try that two-tire change for some track position early on. Although he restarted 16th, it was way back before that. Happy with his race car right now. Smiles.
In that Busch race yesterday, we had that late restart where the guys, late caution, where the guys did come down pit road. Casey Kane decided not to. And Biffle took four tires and almost got there. The key word being...
Almost.
Yes, sir.
Give him about a yard short.
Yep.
It's Rusty Wallace.
Rusty restarted 35th. Kurt Busch inside of Jeff Gordon. That's for fourth. Wallace has only managed to pick up a couple of positions. Lost a lot of time on pit road. Benny, let's go inside the NBC pit window.
All right. The right sides are complete. The tire chains, they're coming around to the left side. Here's the jackknife. We'll watch him as he comes around. That's Ray Callahan. And the jack falls. The tires are half off. They've got to try to lift the car because it's too low. He has to go across the wall, get another jack. He finally gets the car jacked up. Then they can put the tires back on. And all that, as you can see, took lots of time.
Marty Snyder.
And Bill, here's exactly what happened on Rusty Wallace's pit when Bill went to jack it up. The entire weight of Rusty's car was sitting on the very edge of this plate. The car fell off. It's a one stud that they jacked the car up with. It fell off. They had to go get the flat tire jack, which has a lower profile. They slid that underneath the car, and they were able to get this jack out and change the tires with this low profile jack.
So many things can go wrong on pit road. Jeremy Mayfield inside of Elliott Sadler continues to fall back in the field. Alan, how about that 38?
He has not been very happy since his restart, Bill. Called in one lap, said, we got to do something with the air pressure to help me. Called in the next lap, said, I'm loose, I'm sliding all over. Called in the next lap after that and said,
you have got to do something to help me.
Yeah, you can see that right on the restart, Alan. When he slid up the racetrack at four, you can tell the car slid up there, and he just hasn't been able to get a hold of the racetrack.
You know, he mentioned loose. That's when the car is trying to spin out. Let's go inside our Home Depot virtual garage to try to explain loose a little bit better. Car goes around the racetrack. When it's handling perfectly, all four tires are gripping the racetrack equally, as you can see when they're green. But when the rear tires overheat, that's when the car starts sliding in the rear and the driver has his hands full, and it's absolutely the most nervous position that a driver can be in. And I don't blame Elliott Sadler. Fix it.
And how's he going to do that?
Well, they have adjustments, air pressure, change the bolts in the rear on top of the rear springs, rear track bar.
But until the caution comes out, he's got his hands full.
He can do nothing. He's defenseless in the race car until he makes a pit stop.
Matt Kenseth by 1.6 seconds over Greg Biffle. Then it's Kurt Busch, Mark Martin, and Jeff Gordon in the top five at the Kansas Speedway through the field when we come back. The big picture right now at the Kansas Speedway, 17 car of Matt Kenseth. He's led 36 of the 37 laps. A lot of guys on the move. Time to take you through the field. Presented by Speed Pass. Start with Matt Kenseth, and here's Alan.
Yeah, Bill, not much to report on Matt Kenseth. We told you he took right side tires on his pit stop. Pretty happy with his car, and he should be comfortably out in front. And opening up a lead on second place, Greg Biffle, a fellow Roush teammate. Dave?
Here comes Jack Roush's number 16 car. Biffle had four tires changed on that stop. It's run pretty well for him. He's picked up two spots since the restart. The 97 car of Kurt Busch, he started the race on scuffed tires. They put on stickers on this last run, and he radioed in, "This car likes stickers." He has moved up from the eighth position. Matt?
Now, not a Roush-keteer, but he has that Roush Yates horsepower under the hood. Is Dale Jarrett, last week's winner. The balance, not good. He's already gone a lap down. Not the day that Jarrett and Parrott had hoped for. Dave?
Matt, the sixth car of Mark Martin goes backwards from the start, restarted in third. He said to Pat Trice, his crew chief, before that stop, "If you want to try too, that's fine with me." Doesn't appear to be working out for him right now, Matty.
Jeff Gordon runs fifth, trying for his first mile and a half to 2 mile win since Indy of 04. Now, the car, not bad, but he is pushing. You see him move up slightly off of four. The car is tight, especially up off turn four, AB.
Jeremy Mayfield's team has just told him, "You are the fastest car on the racetrack these last five laps." Wasn't watching the timing monitor. I can't back it up. Well, see the caution flag here.
Caution is out for debris. 40 laps are complete. Our second caution of the day. There it is.
Well, Dale Jarrett gets a break.
Wow, that's...
What is that?
Run down there and pick that up. What do you want?
I think it's hot.
Pace vehicle to pit road. Green flag about to come out for the restart. Matt Kenseth leads. Dale Earnhardt Jr. too fast on pit road. Tail end of the longest line, and that's a long line because everybody's on the lead lap. Now, Kurt Busch is a teammate of Matt Kenseth, and he would like 5 bonus points for leading a lap. We'll see what happens. Meanwhile, behind them,
he would like Matt to give it to him.
Right, exactly.
That's what he really would like, but
Tony Stewart may play a role in that decision.
Greg Biffle about to lose a spot to Stewart in that 20 car.
Ooh, Stewart a little bit loose up the racetrack.
Whoa! Greg Biffle a little bit loose as well. Marty, how about Tony Stewart?
Well, he complimented his guys on a terrific pit stop, and it was for these guys. They also made a track bar adjustment, including that wedge and air pressure adjustment for Tony. He said, "You know, it just takes the car too long to come in. We lose too much ground to these other guys. I've spent so long being loose that by the time my car comes in, they're gone, and I can't catch them."
Guess what? It's still loose.
Kenseth leads.
And his pit crew held serve once again as we go inside our Craftsman pit summary and see Biffle lost a spot at Tony Stewart, 8th to 4th. That was a terrific stop.
So far, Matt has been able to hold off the 97. Even though you know his teammate wants those 5 bonus points for leading a lap. Matt first on the track and first off of pit road. Here are the guys that got it done for car 17.
Robbie Reiser, Allenton, Wisconsin.
Chris Brook, Davie, Florida.
Justin Nottestead, Cambridge, Wisconsin.
Russ Strupp, Allenton, Wisconsin.
Zach Yarnott, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
Jeremy West, Los Angeles, California.
Greg Ebert, Marshall, Wisconsin.
Dave McDonald, Clinton, Michigan.
Wayne Deloria, Biddeford, Maine, now Hickory, North Carolina.
Well, guys, you did great.
Yep, they sure did. Dave Burns.
We know that Kurt Busch would like to get by and lead at least at the finish line to get those 5 bonus points. His crew recommending to all listening on the radio, now would be a perfect time.
Wonder if Matt's listening to their radio. Yeah.
Well, the 97's got to catch him first. I think if he does and starts pressuring him, then Kenseth will probably let him have those 5 points. But,
yeah.
Alan, does Matt have a plan?
I don't know if he has a plan, but it has been communicated to him from his spotter Mike Kalinoff that Kurt Busch would like to lead a lap. I think he wanted to get away from Tony Stewart a little bit before they try and make that happen. You might see it in the next couple circuits.
Now you got Pitbull in there taking the third spot, so now would be a good time.
So Roush cars run first, second, third, and Mark Martin in fifth also run a Roush ride. Carl Edwards, the fifth Roush car, is back in 19th. Is that where you were going?
Mm-hmm.
Sorry about that.
Yep.
Sterling Marlin right there, he's just picked up the sixth position.
And Sterling, I've been kind of watching the 40 car as the race is unwinding, and he has got a great run going. And remember, a couple of years ago, his season ended here in Kansas. Marty, what's Sterling saying?
It had a terrific run, BP. You're exactly right. Car's been just a little bit loose into turn 3 for Sterling, so they went down on the track bar trying to help that out on this last time. Brand new race car. This is the latest, greatest Ganassi piece. The best body, the best engine, trying things for next year, trying to get better for next year. Sterling will not be with this team, however, next year, but they're putting on a good show today with a terrific race car.
And Benny, you were talking about that hard crash and how it did end his season, but really there were some thoughts after finding out he had the broken bone in his neck. It could have been a career-ending injury.
Easily.
So you talk about drivers never like to say a track owes them one, but Sterling would love to post a good finish here. Tony Stewart, Mark Martin looking at him. There's Sterling. Dropping back to the 24. Matt, what's up?
Well, he's starting out way too free, Bill, at the beginning of the run. That's why he dropped from fifth. Now trying to hold his own back in ninth, just waiting for that car to tighten up. And really, he is just sitting there. And while if you're a driver, you can make an adjustment from inside the cockpit with the brake bias if you need to. But he's hoping that this car will tighten up as the run progresses. Alan?
Talking about Jimmy Johnson and his progress in the race so far, one of the championship contenders. Jimmy started in 22nd position. He has moved up in the early laps. Small adjustments on his car on their last pit stop. One round in the right rear, trying to get the car to handle a little bit better for him through the corner. Right now, just tracking Jeff Gordon on the Speedway.
Thanks, guys. There's Johnson.
And what Matt was talking about with Jeff Gordon was if your car's loose in, drivers have a brake adjustment. They can change the bias from front to rear. Sometimes if the car's loose in, you can put front brake in it. That car right there is loose. Just watching it. But if the car's loose in the middle and off, not a whole lot you can do about it.
Gordon inside of Elliott Sadler. Moves Jeff up to eighth. Drop back in the field to Rusty Wallace, Marty Snyder.
And Rusty's been very calm on the radio since their problem on pit road earlier, trying to slowly work his way back up through the field methodically, if you will. The car's been kind of neutral for Rusty, a little bit to the tight side at the end of the run. So on this last stop, they took a pound out of both left side tires, trying to loosen it up for Rusty, who told me earlier today, you know what, I'm not enjoying this final season enough. I need to slow down a little bit. I've been too busy lately to enjoy what is my final season in the Cup Series.
Now Ryan Newman has started out the chase with a first, a fifth, and a fourth, hoping to continue that here, but this has not been the day he had hoped for. But the team, even though they've had a lot of issues so early on, keeping spirits very light on the radio.
How's it driving, Ryan?
It's okay. Give me a second. I'll make up something. Time's actually look pretty decent, Ryan. Quit trying to be positive, aren't we? I'm serious, actually. I know.
Now he is working on the back of the nine of Casey Kane, trying to work the bottom. The car, though, has been on the loose side at the beginning of the run. Car, though, still fast, but he's way back in 31st. Meyer deeply in traffic. We talked so much about track position, so important here.
Under green here at the Kansas Speedway, Matt Kenseth continues to lead. Take a look at our Auto Zone in the zone drivers. This season, statistically, Ryan Newman, three straight top five finishes, but struggling early here today. Race leader Matt Kenseth, six top tens in the last seven races. And Tony Stewart, the championship leader, performing well in the second half of the season and in the chase.
That Tony Stewart is definitely in the zone in 2005.
Tell you what, this is getting tight up here between Kenseth and Busch and Biffle. Kenseth had to go high a couple times to pass some slower cars, which let Kurt Busch and Greg Biffle gain some track.
What are they thinking?
We're leading.
Matt did just knock Dale Jarrett off the lead lap.
Was there some talk this weekend about limiting the amount of cars that a owner can own?
Yes, Brian France, NASCAR CEO, talked about it yesterday. And basically in a couple of weeks, they're going to come out with a plan that is going to limit the amount of cars one owner can have. And there already is a rule, basically in the rule book, of how many teams one owner can have. But teams have been able to circumvent that by using
different names,
family members, right.
Well, Jack Roush, we all know that he has five cars. You have these three plus Mark Martin and Carl Edwards, but he only has two cars in his name.
Right.
The 17 car, Mark Martin is listed as the owner. The 97 car, I think Georgetta Roush, mm-hmm. Jack's mother, is listed as owner. And I think Jeff Smith is the owner of the 16 car.
Well, I saw Brian France downstairs this morning, and he said they're going to put a hard cap on it, that they have alerted owners that this is coming. They're going to talk to them soon, and in about 2 weeks we'll have more information on it. But basically what they want to do is they want to try and help make the sport stronger by strengthening the ability of smaller teams to compete week in and week out, like, for instance, a Wood Brothers or somebody along those lines that doesn't have the ability to afford a multi-car operation. So we'll see what happens. You can imagine what the reaction in the garage is going to be.
Some are going to be happy.
Yeah.
And some, like Jack Roush, are going to be very sad. Right. And Kurt Busch, all of a sudden, Wally, I'm really impressed. He's trying something different. He's running a high line, and it seems to be working very well for him.
Yeah, he's pretty much running where the 17 isn't, or he's looking for, you know, real estate where 17 is not running, and he's pulled up right there. So see if he can see if the 17 gives him the wave by, so those guys can lead. But boy, that's hard for a driver to do. I don't care if it's your teammates or not,
especially when you've led every lap but one.
Because then, you know, once he does it for the 97, he's going to have to do it for the 16 too.
Marty?
Well, Bill, there is a new Arena Football League team in Kansas City, and Kevin Porter is the head coach of that team. And Kevin, I understand you guys are hosting some very special guests this weekend.
Yes, we are, and very happy to do it. There's a family here from New Orleans that was basically in the same situation that I was in when we left New Orleans to come here. So about 20 of them, staying with some people here, and, you know, we're fortunate to be able to host them. Our hearts and prayers go out to the people in the Gulf Coast, and, you know, we're just happy that we're able to do something for them.
And the process, Kevin's very interesting. The New Orleans team is actually, entire team's packing up, moving to Kansas City, and you guys will play in Kansas City next year, correct?
Absolutely. Unfortunate situation that happened with the team for them to have to move, but, you know, it was a good situation for Kansas City. The Kansas City Sports and Entertainment Group went in and purchased the team and brought the team here, and I think that Kansas City is going to be a wonderful market for Arena Football.
And Kevin, who was the assistant coach in New Orleans last year, will be the head coach in Kansas City this year, and the AFL kicks off on NBC on January 28th, Bill.
Thanks, Marty.
And Kurt Busch is in. Biffle, how come you didn't let me get up there and get those 5 points?
Dave, you got an answer for that?
Can you believe, Bill, I'm scanning a lot of Roush cars right now?
I can believe that.
Okay, it's a little bit confusing, but here we go. The 16 car does not expect any favors right now. Crew Chief Doug Richard radioed to his driver, you know what, you guys are running identical times. I'm going to let you play your game. That's a game you don't want to have any contact with right now. As for the 97 of Kurt Busch, after Greg Biffle got by him, Kurt claimed that he was about to get the 17, but his car got tight, and then he lost that spot. Here goes Biffle for the lead.
I think 16's going to get those 5 points, BP.
Looks that way. He's on the inside, has that preferred position, and Kenseth is going to let him go.
I don't know if he really had a whole lot of choice on that.
I don't guess he did he?
You think Biffle's car is getting stronger?
I think Biffle's car is pretty good right now.
It looks like maybe the 17 car was slowing down because it looked like Tony Stewart and Martin was getting closer to him. Alan, what's he saying, the 17 driver?
You know, we can always count on the 73 champ to be all over it. That's exactly what he said. My car is getting tight, starting to slow down, just as Biffle got to his back bumper.
And that 97 car, did you see how it smoked down there?
Would you see how hard he drove into the corner? He drove forever down there, turn one, and the car's really pushing up the racetrack right now.
And here comes that 20 car, Marty.
Yeah, here he comes, BP, and as we advertise, that pit stop help and the changes they made help. Tony said it's a little free getting back to the gas still, but the car getting much better and clearly much faster on this run for the champion, or the NEXTEL Cup points leader, we should say, right now on this run than it was the run before.
75 laps are complete here at the Kansas Speedway. Greg, 80 laps are complete. Greg Biffle continues to lead, but for his teammate Kurt Busch, the defending series champion, he has just made an unscheduled pit stop for right side tires.
Actually, he took four.
He did take four?
Yeah.
Okay.
And you can see currently running in the 39th position. But we saw him smoking that right front for a couple laps in the corner, so I guess the car was just so tight, he was pushing, smoking that right front. He felt like sooner or later he's going to have some problems, and maybe he did have a problem.
And the car Kurt is racing right now would be the 92 car of P.J. Jones. P.J. Jones would get the lucky dog if the caution came out. He's 38th. Busch is 39th. Dave.
And, Bill, they've been looking over the tires. It took them a long time to really find anything wrong with that right front tire, but it was low on pressure. So that is the situation, but they haven't circled any big gash or anything. Kind of a mystery.
Well, we watched the last, you know, a couple laps there, Dave, and when he was going into the corner of the car, it was definitely sliding up the racetrack. He had a big push in it, so. But he is about to catch the 92 of P.J. Jones. Go ahead, Dave.
Wally, one more note from crew chief Jimmy Fenning on that. Kurt, take care of that right front tire. So they want him to watch how he's been driving a little bit also. Maybe some chassis adjustment that they made to that that's affecting how aggressive they are on that right front.
And also the 17 car, Matt Kenseth, is going back. He's back now to the ninth position. Alan, what's going on?
BP, a long debate on the radio. Matt called in, said, I've got a tire vibrating. I've got a bad shake in the car. I feel like something's going wrong. They've talked about whether or not they need to pit now or whether they should stay out on the racetrack. The spotter Mike Kalinoff said NASCAR may be looking at debris, hang with it. Matt said, let's not get ourselves in a problem. They're ready for him down here. They're just trying to stall it off as long as they can.
Ricky Rudd has passed him for ninth. Right in front of Rudd is Ken Schrader, who's having a good run in the eighth spot.
There is a bunch of debris again. I just don't know what they're going to do. It's a bunch of big pieces of tire, and there's a whole fender laying on the front stretch. It's been there the whole time.
NASCAR says the track is clear despite Matt's
What he was
help.
Talking about is a piece of tape on the front stretch. We've been seeing that. It blew off Junior's car several laps ago when they tried to put a piece of tape on for some aerodynamics, and it blew off.
Up front, Greg Biffle leads. Update from Dave Burns.
Between the Roush teams, information passes when there is concern, and Doug Richard, crew chief for Greg Biffle, just told him, watch the right front. So similar setups perhaps in these Fords, and they want to be careful about how aggressive they're driving the cars into the corner and abusing that right front.
Michael Walter makes an unscheduled stop on the pit road.
There's the 15 of Walter.
Well, you got to make a call when you're a driver. You know, you can explain what the car's doing for so long, but it's your call. If you think you need to come in, if that tire's going to blow, if you think you're having problems, and Matt looked like he was slowing down to come into the pit entrance, but it looks like he just didn't get the car slowed down enough, but he missed pit entrance.
I think you're exactly right, Wally.
That apron coming out of pit road, and I went back out. Then they're going to throw a caution, but I don't know what they're doing here. What do you want me to do?
Hang on. Where's the leader right now?
They're looking for a piece of debris down on the apron in turn one.
Okay, we can hang out if
You can hang out there.
Boy, that's tough sledding. That's something a driver does not want to do when he feels like something is wrong with the car. He wants to go in and get it attended to.
Well, that's what I was saying. A driver finally has to make the call and see how bad it is. If the car starts really vibrating or you really feel as a driver there's something wrong through the seat of your pants, you need to come in, because if that tire blows or the wheel comes off or whatever, then you've done so much damage, it's too late.
So you got to listen to what?
You got to listen to your butt.
Okay. Yeah,
Bill.
Keep me up on that debris here now.
Well, you would think if there was debris down there that NASCAR would have thrown the caution a couple of laps ago. I mean, it's not going to disappear.
But it's on the apron. If it's on the apron, then NASCAR won't call a caution. So if it's not on the racetrack.
Two more, we're going to pit.
Okay, Robbie Reiser has made the call. Two more laps, they're going to get for a caution flag. If it doesn't come out, they're going to come into the pits.
And that's because NASCAR has said the track is clear. No debris. Take a look at our Wendy's race menu as we watch Matt Kenseth. Next Saturday night, under the lights, the Lowe's Motor Speedway in Charlotte, another mile and a half track, then the short track at Martinsville, Virginia, 12:30 Eastern time. Then on to Atlanta and Texas, 2 mile and a half tracks as the chase for the NEXTEL Cup, exclusively on NBC.
And the guy that's currently second in the chase for the NEXTEL Cup, Ryan Newman, was just lapped by Greg Biffle back in the 32nd position.
And Matt's times right now are not that bad. I mean, compared to what the, well, actually that lap, it was a 32.90. So Jeremy Mayfield ran a 32.30. So he's about 0.5 seconds off.
And Jeremy Mayfield has moved up to the second position. He's gotten by Tony Stewart, Mark Martin, all the rest of them.
And Matt Kenseth desperately wants to come to pit road. His conversation a moment ago.
It's not that bad, but we're just asking for trouble. I mean, they're just asking for it right now. So I'm trying to tell you, but I'll run as long as you want.
So he knows the situation is only going to get worse.
It's tough for a driver to make that call, because if you come in and there's nothing wrong, then you have to live with that for the rest of the year. But on the other hand, if something does blow, then you got to live with that too.
Yep. We'll keep an eye on Matt. If trouble breaks out, we'll break in. You're watching the NASCAR NEXTEL Cup chase for the championship on NBC.
Yellow, yellow, yellow.
The caution has just come out. Caution has come out.
Rodney Wise, you are the man as far as Matt Kenseth is concerned. And there is a piece of aluminum on the racetrack. Certainly needs to be gotten up.
Didn't even have to break out.
Now, that's not, I mean, that's actually on the apron. It's not on the racetrack, just to make that clear.
Greg Biffle is the race leader. Michael Waltrip is at the tail end of the lead lap.
Wow, Tony Stewart did not get a good restart at all.
Jeremy Mayfield at 19 car going by. Trying to go by.
Michael Waltrip smoking.
He's got some fender damage on the left front.
We got a fender rub, guys. The 97 just went into us. We got a fender rub here.
Joey Meyer, the spotter, relaying that information to the crew.
97 is Kurt Busch.
That 66 car is Kevin LePage. He is a lap down. And Mike Wallace, four car. All these car, these three cars, Michael Waltrip, 66, four, all one lap down.
But right now, the first car lap down is Kurt Busch, and right behind him, Ryan Newman. They would be racing for the lucky dog.
Actually, Kurt Busch is in front of Greg Biffle, Bill.
That's correct. Good so, point, BP. So he would get to come around.
Ryan Newman would be the lucky dog.
Yes. So Busch is the last car. He's on the tail end of the lead lap right now. Biffle in the 16 is the race leader. Those cars are teammates.
Wow, Mayfield.
The points
five
as they run.
Spots up. As yep. Now.
Then what, that 19 car Mayfield a great run today. Currently in a battle with the 40, Sterling Marlin for the second position.
Mayfield's teammate Casey Kane won the Busch race here yesterday. Update from Allen.
Now you guys were just talking about Jeremy Mayfield and the great points day he's having so far, as crew chief Slugger Labby knows. Got one car on the wall.
Stuart Kirby, Allen, and yeah, the caution is out. And that will bring Kurt Busch around, and it looks like Ryan Newman will wait for official confirmation that Ryan Newman will be the lucky dog. That would put Newman back on the lead lap as well. And that is confirmed. Ryan Newman is the lucky dog.
Big break for both those guys.
Huge break.
So Busch being strong on the restart helped.
Not so big a break for Stuart Kirby.
Nope.
Young man from Bowling Green, Kentucky.
This is already underway when we get it, but you see Kurt or Stuart ride it up into the wall. And go back and look at the restart, guys.
See, Michael, up on the high side. And watch Kurt Busch kind of slide up the racetrack. Just a little bit of contact between Kurt Busch's rear bumper and the front of Michael Waltrip's car.
Isn't that amazing? It looks like it just, like it could not have possibly damaged the car, but we saw the result in all the smoke. Dave?
And BP, the smoke went away. That's why they kept Michael out for that period of time. They are happy, though. The caution came out. Now they will come out there.
104 laps are complete. Coming around to finish 105. The green's out of Kansas.
Mike Wallace wants that back. Boy, he was loose 10 on the bottom.
Jeremy Mayfield, who runs second, is a contender in the chase for the NEXTEL Cup, and he would love to get around that 16 and get those 5 bonus points for leading a lap. You watching that 4 car?
Yeah, if he doesn't get taken out by the two guys wrecking in front of him.
Mike Wallace, the first car, lap down in the 4.
Tony Stewart has gotten by Sterling Marlin. Let's see the orange 20 car trying to get on by Michael Waltrip to pull up on the Jeremy Mayfield car in the 19. On board with Tony. Hey, well, Mike Wallace hanging pretty tough in that 4 car.
Jeremy Mayfield wants by.
And you know what, Bill?
He's going to try right about now.
I think he's going to make it.
So Mayfield in second now sets its sights on Biffle. And Stewart will look to make the move under Mike Wallace.
Stewart will get under Mike Wallace now. See if he can track down Mayfield.
Matt Kenseth runs in the 7th position. Allen.
Well, you know, Bill, we've talked a couple times today about Matt Kenseth and Kurt Busch and Greg Biffle and the Roush teammates racing for the championship and whether or not they should be trading the lead for bonus points, those extra points given for guys who lead a lap. It's a complicated situation between these teammates.
I want to be friends with everybody. Everybody wants to lead laps. I understand all that, and you're just relaying the message. But when it gets to the chase, we're all racing each other for a championship, and I'm not going to get beat by 4 points at the end of the year because I gave away a free 5 somewhere. So we're all just going to have to race to get them. That's just the way it's got to be right now until somebody's out of it. I mean, it's not team orders. We got to race for ourselves, too. I mean, I'm not trying to be a hog. They help us during the year, and I help them during the year. But when it comes down to it, right now we're racing each other. So that's just the way it is.
It's one of the big complexities of this championship with having 5 Roush Racing teammates competing for the title. Wally, how would you feel if you let a guy lead a lap for 5 bonus points and he beat you for the title by 4?
Alan, I mean, you and I have been hanging out in this booth for a few years. You know how I feel about it. I am not for that at all. I'm dead against giving teammates or anybody a free pass by you so they can get 5 points. I don't agree with it. And I think Matt is dead on. There's got to be a point in this deal where you just say, hey, you want the points, earn it. Because if it comes down and you lose this thing by just one move on the racetrack by giving your teammate points,
Boy, you are going to not sleep at night.
And the championship last year was decided by just 8 points.
Yeah.
Which is two positions.
And while Matt runs in that seventh position, Rusty Wallace and Mark Martin are trying to catch and pass him. There's Kyle Busch, Brian Vickers, the 45 of Kyle Petty.
Those cars running back 20th, 21st, 22nd.
It'll be interesting to see if these guys, the 5 and 25, let's see if they get back their groove after the shock situation to see if, you know, that was a lot of the way they ran so good or not.
Kurt Busch back on the lead lap, runs 28. Dave?
Hey, Bill, we got any onboard telemetry we can run in the 97? There's some. How about that? 10.23 seconds behind the leader, Greg Biffle. Well, when they were working on the right side of that car, they were pulling away an air hose that was had fallen off and beaten Kurt on the arm. He said, I don't want that anymore. What's it to? It's to the Pi data system that gives the telemetry to television. So if this telemetry right here goes away, it's because the system overheated because they took off that hose. But it wasn't properly installed, apparently, and so they ripped it out.
So the hose was blowing air on the system. Is that what you're saying?
That's what I'm saying. And unfortunately, one end of it was off, and it was beating Kurt on the arm. He didn't like it.
And we can see going down in turn one on our system shows him 195 miles per hour.
And that's right.
That is right.
That's not
still
wrong.
Functioning.
That's right.
Look at this. Michael Waltrip not on the lead lap. Rusty Wallace in the 2. Mark Martin in the 6.
Ooh,
right. Johnson is there.
Yeah. Johnson. There goes Paul Edwards. He took advantage of that chop.
Right now, chasers run 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th, and 11th.
Hey, well, I'm impressed with the job that Jeff Gordon and that crew are doing today. Sure, they're only running in 6th position, but it's so much better than they've been running on this type of racetrack.
And that's how they're going to measure their success in the final 7 races.
They didn't. I don't think they expected to go from 20th to 1st, but this is a terrific run for them.
Gordon, a 2-time winner here. A couple of Roush cars with a Hendrick car behind them. There's Jeff Gordon. How about it, Matt?
Steve Letard asked Jeff, compare earlier in the race when the car was tight to how tight it is now. He says, I really don't want to because I'm so much farther back. When I was up front, I had a lot more cleaner air. Now the air is so dirty, I don't want to get ourselves headed in an even worse direction by telling you how the car is, because I'm just telling you now, we need to free the car up. It's still a little free on entry, but it's just so tight in the center, Marty.
Well, Matt, the lap time still look very good for Tony Stewart. Let's talk to Greg Zipidelli. How concerned are you about the voltage issue?
Well, obviously, whenever you have a problem, we've had some problems with the alternators. The motor department's been working hard on it, but I don't think we fixed it. We shut everything off, switched batteries. We're prepared to put another battery in if it starts to drop. So we'll just keep our fingers crossed. Hopefully, some Depot Chevrolet will we can get us a good finish today.
So far, the lap times still look very good for the 20 car.
That can't be a fun ride. Keeps the driver on his edge. This race at a record pace. 119 is the lap count. Greg Biffle leads. We'll go through the field when we return to Kansas. Under caution, a single car spin by Boris said he's okay. Guys on pit road to Dave Burns.
Not the only car on pit lane. Greg Biffle says don't change it. They asked him if he wanted a wedge change. Nah, just leave it. 4 tires and fuel. Marty.
They only changed Tony Stewart when it was a piece of tape because his air hose fell out of his helmet, so he wants to tape that in. 4 tires, no changes to the chassis, Matt.
Ricky Rudd, who almost won this race last year, just moved into the top 5. A tear off the windshield. The car almost perfect. Allen.
Matt Kenseth and Jeremy Mayfield in the first 2 pits, yellow and black cars. Matt Kenseth said he can't get his car to turn to the bottom line on the racetrack. They're making adjustments for that. Jeremy Mayfield from 3rd place called in before the yellow, thought they had a tire going down. His crew chief Slugger Labber told him about Matt Kenseth's tails from earlier. They wrote it out, they got the caution, they're in good shape. The dash off of pit road, Mark Martin and Ken Schrader, probably just 2 tires. We'll double check. Here's why we're under caution. Boris said in the 36 ride.
I tell you what, he nailed that throttle, didn't he? And kept that car spin and kept it off the wall. Boris, I'm impressed.
Boris brings out the caution. The field comes to pit road. Mark Martin, chasing his first NEXTEL Cup championship, takes two tires and leads him off pit road. Mark Martin leads him to the green.
And he's right of that 49 car up in that second spot.
Came in 15th, now second. Mike Bliss came in 18th, went out fifth. Joe Nemechek came in 24th, went out 12th. And Kurt Busch has worked his way up to 21st. And now everybody chasing Mark Martin, who is chasing his first series championship after finishing second four times.
Trader just took two, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, you can tell he's
sounded good at the time, huh?
He's having a hard time right now just getting by the 11 car.
It's Denny Hamlin making his first.
And Tony Stewart is wanting to go, but he's just waiting for one of these lanes to open up.
First start for Hamlin in the NASCAR NEXTEL Cup Series.
And Greg Biffle's 16 car is struggling to get going on this restart.
Meantime, Marcus checked out.
And we got a genuine mess going on back here.
We sure do. That's behind Schrader, Alan.
Yeah, just want to add on Schrader, Bill. That 15th, that's about as low as he's run all race long. They took two tires on the first stop to get track position and have been in the top 10 right until they lost a couple of spots at the end of that last run. They're having a very solid day.
I'll say strong run for Schrader here at Kansas.
It's like the 17 car of Kenseth. Thought he had Biffle passed off turn two, but
he's working on it.
He's working on trying to get by him.
This is out of turn four. Now the trioval to the start finish line. Martin leads, needs to have a successful day here to enhance his chances in the chase for the championship.
Because he caught a tough break last week at Talladega, being involved in that crash, finishing what, 41st?
And the big one, didn't even work up a sweat. There's Mike Bliss, we just talked about him in the zero car. He's behind these guys.
Earnhardt Jr. there, he's in 34th spot, but he is the, well, he is the first car left.
You're going to say he's in position for the
lap. Got away with it, right?
Talked about Ken Schrader running well. Mike Bliss, strong. Sterling Marlin in the top 10 right now. Marty Snyder on car 8, Marty.
Yes, that indeed is the truth, Bill, and it has just not been a fun day for Dale Earnhardt Jr. Ever since they got in that early wreck, they've had left rear fender damage. They've never been able to get the car the way they wanted to, and this is very disappointing because this is a brand new car out of Dale Jr. Stables, and they had planned on it being the workhorse for this last few races of the year. They were going to run to Charlotte, they were going to Atlanta, Texas, and Homestead, but after the way it's performed today, I'm not sure that they want to take it to those places.
Well, Marty, first of all, it's pretty tough to just kind of say it's not working out too well. This is a racetrack that you have to have your body work in one piece. It can't be tore up because aerodynamics means so much here at downforce. And that car obviously doesn't have much after being bounced off the 88 and a couple other cars. So not really a good test to say that, man, this car is not really good, because you see the left rear fender, there is none really.
Now Biffle is warning by that 11 car. Looks like he's going to get positioned. Nope, couldn't do it.
I'll tell you, Mark Martin.
Here comes Kenseth. He ran out of room. Take a look at the outside. He wants to get back, Biffle. Dave.
And Biffle trying to get around the 11. Didn't mention the number, but he just said to his spotter, Joel, you better go tell him. Biffle wants by that 11.
Alan.
And Bill, talking about Matt Kenseth earlier, remember I talked about they made a handling adjustment on that last pit stop, trying to get his car to turn down to that white line at the bottom of the racetrack. Back in traffic, doesn't have as much downforce on the nose of the car from the air because he's in the traffic behind the other cars. That's what they're trying to compensate for to get him back up to the front.
Oh, this is bad news for Mark Martin. Leader halfway has failed to win all four races.
Hope he's not watching.
No, he probably isn't. But he has fans.
Well, and he watches every race. Goes back and watches them on tape. Right now, Mark, you're out front by 1.4 seconds.
You get a report card? Does he tell you how wonderful you
we
are?
We talk about it. He has.
Because you know you don't get it from us.
Hey, there we go. Carl Edwards go by Sterling Marlin and Jeremy Mayfield. Sterling in 40, Jeremy in 19. And Rusty Wallace and that deuce up in the mix. These guys racing.
Right in here.
I tell you, Rusty is, has 10. Worked his way. And I mean worked back to the 10th spot there, Marty.
Yeah, we talked about Rusty's methodical march back up through the field, and the car has been so good. He's been very patient with it. The last two stops, they have made no changes. Rusty describes the car as neutral, and he notices when other cars around him tend to get tight, he tends to get faster than them as he breaks in the top 10 there, passing Sterling.
It's kind of a home track for Rusty Wallace from Missouri. Right next door said it would be huge for him to win here today. His final visit here, last call, last season for Rusty in the NEXTEL Cup Series, making his 700th career start today. A veteran trying to win his second championship. Up front, it is Mark Martin trying to win his first. In the three previous races here at Kansas, Mark's best finish, 20th. But in the inaugural race at the Kansas Speedway, 6th for car 6. He leads. Still under green here at Kansas, Mark Martin leads by 2 seconds over championship leader Tony Stewart. And that takes us to our Miller Race Fact. The championship leader coming into Kansas has finished 25th or worse in two of the last three races.
Another good thing Tony doesn't watch this one.
Another uplifting statistical number. This is for third, Greg Biffle under Ken Schrader. Biffle takes the position. Let's take you through the field, starting with Mark Martin. Here's Davey.
Hey, Bill, for the second time today, Mark Martin's team tried the two right side tires only strategy on that last pit stop. The first time they were mired back in traffic, and Mark said, these guys are killing me. The car wouldn't handle. Out front, look at it go. Marty?
Well, Dave, the statistic Bill just showed us, Tony Stewart is hoping does not come true. He's finished top 10 in three of his four Kansas races. Now, under the caution, they checked with him once again about the volts. He said they're holding fine between 12 and 12.5. Chassis, very good right now, Dave.
Greg Biffle ignoring the campfires and working his way back to the front. Started fourth on this last restart. Has picked up a position, working his way toward his teammate at the head of the field. Alan?
Well, Ken Schrader said, I'm a little too loose, but not bad. I would say not bad. He's hanging in there well after taking just the two tires. And like I said a little while ago, he's been right in the top 10 most of this race, Marty.
Mike Bliss is a former Kansas winner in the Craftsman Truck Series, that is. Two tires on the last stop, and he's held his ground. He came out fifth and restarted fifth, and he's running fifth right now. Car's a little bit too loose off the corners, Alan.
Well, the key for Matt Kenseth now is to get his track position back. Try and get this car back toward the front so he can race for the win. He is running back now in sixth position and trying to close in on Mike Bliss for fifth. Marty?
Alan, Carl Edwards loves these mile-and-a-half racetracks. Good for him that five of the last seven races will be at racetracks, just like this one. The car is starting to come around, getting better for Carl the longer they run today. And they reminded him others in the chase have had problems. Rusty Wallace had problems earlier, but he has since recovered, now running eighth. Car's getting a little bit too tight for Rusty. They're considering adding 1 pound to the right rear tire on this next stop, Alan.
Jeremy Mayfield has fallen back just a bit in the field, now running in ninth spot. He reports the back end of his car is wiggling around a little too much for his comfort at 180-something miles an hour. Jimmy Johnson running now in 10th spot. Hasn't really gotten up and challenged for a top five position all day as he bids for the championship. Jimmy told me earlier this weekend that the chase for the NEXTEL Cup 2005 feels different than it did 12 months ago.
Last year, I lived on every event leading up to the chase, and then when the chase started. And granted, we all show up every day and put in 100%, but the first few races, to me, it was more about not losing the championship. And last year, we did that. We didn't perform. I made some mistakes. We had some part failures and lost the championship then. The end of the chase, we did everything we could to win it. Just came up 8 points short. So this year, I've just got a much more relaxed approach to it. The team does. And you know, not only are we smarter as the Lowe's 48 team, but I think everybody in the garage area is a little bit smarter. So I don't feel like I have an advantage. But I think as the chase wears on, all the teams are going to be more, be able to adapt to it a little easier.
Jimmy says these next couple of races, including Kansas here today, are going to begin to shake the field out over who will contend for the title come Homestead.
Bill? Thanks, Alan. That's a top 10 through the field. Mark Martin leads Tony Stewart by a second and a half. Eight of the guys in the chase for the championship run in the top 10. We continue to go through the field. Here's Matt.
Bill, 13 laps ago, the 48 of Johnson and the 21 of Rudd were the two fastest race cars on the track. Right now, Ricky's running in the 11th position. They didn't make any changes in the last stop. The car is good. He's just right now riding along. Snyder?
Matt, Casey Mears driving the car that he finished sixth with at Indianapolis. A little loose end, tight off for Casey. The car has been getting better all day long in that pink race car. Sterling Marlin did a cool thing yesterday. He gave his airplane to crew chief Steve Boyer, and snap, he was in Lincoln, Nebraska watching the Cornhuskers lose their football game. Unfortunately, the car a little bit too tight for Sterling right now. Water, a little bit of a concern. 250, Matt.
Now, Jeff Gordon's day has taken a turn for the worse. Not only is the car very twitchy and tight, he's stuck back in dirty air, but he also said under the last caution he felt like something broke in the front of the car. He could hear it snap. Snyder?
Matt, Jamie McMurray came on the radio just about five laps ago, said, guys, the car, the best it's been all day long. We've done a good job of making it better throughout the race. Let's continue that. He's finished seventh and eighth in his two Kansas races, looking for another top 10 today, Dave.
Marty, that right front that went down on Kurt Busch's car, that was a blistered inner shoulder on that car. So they've been very careful adjusting the right front, but he needed the car to turn a little bit better on the last pit stop, so they took a little air out of it. Has not helped much, Alan.
Well, after starting this race on the front row in second position, Elliott Sadler slipped back to 17th. We told you earlier in the race, this was a new chassis. Among the things they're learning, how it responds to different changes during a race, and they're learning as they go. Matt?
Joe Nemechek's last win, this event 1 year ago. You can see him in the 01 car. If you take a close look, a lot of damage to the grill back on lap 53. He came on the radio, said, I ran into the back of him, which I believe was the 9. The car, temperature climbing up over 250 degrees. Alan?
Brian Vickers is trying to make up lost ground. Back on their pit stop at lap 94, they had a problem getting fuel in the car. He had to come back in, go all the way to the tail end of the field. So Vickers is running well. He's just still back in 18th. Matt?
The biggest issue for Casey Kane in the 9, he's in his backup car after crashing during qualifying. The car has been loose all day long, very fast, but he just cannot get any grip, especially on entry. Now as we go further back in the field, the last of the chasers back in 27th, the 12, Ryan Newman, ended the day only 4 points out of the championship lead, but his day started out bad. Right now he's telling crew chief Matt Borland, I won't tell you about the balance of the car until we get close to pitting, but his biggest concern, the water temperature, 240 degrees. He keeps trying to duck out, trying to get some clean air into that grill to cool it down, guys.
Thank you, guys. Great job down there. 33 cars are on the lead lap. The last one, as Boris said, everyone is chasing Mark Martin. He leads by 1.6 seconds over Tony Stewart. You're watching NASCAR on NBC. NBC Sports is at the Kansas Speedway in Kansas City for the Banquet 400. Fourth race in the chase for the NEXTEL Cup. Just been a spectacular weekend here in Kansas City. Today, sunny, about 70 degrees. Had to scrape the window a couple of mornings on the way to the track to get the frost off of it. Mark Martin leads.
Well, wait a minute.
What?
Some of us didn't leave at 3 o'clock this morning to get here.
That's not the point. Okay. Benny, save me here, would you? Cue the duck or something, would you?
Oh, is it time?
Yes.
Come on, folks, down the truck, please. Cue the duck. What do you have for us today?
It's going to come migrating across the screen here. And here's our Aflac trivia question. How many races did Richard Petty win after his 700th start?
And we're playing on Rusty Wallace's 700th start today.
Right.
Let's see. How many races did Richard Petty win? Probably one.
22.
Oh, my goodness.
But you were close.
Yeah, I was close. Let's see.
Wow.
He didn't retire until 92, so he ran a lot of races after 700, didn't he?
Let's see. Here's how the chase contenders are doing today. Tony Stewart has switched to a backup battery. Ryan Newman has struggled most of the day, currently runs 27th. Rusty Wallace had a jack break in the pits, but Rusty has worked his way up to 8th. Jimmy Johnson has been as high as 2nd today. He runs in the top 10. Greg Biffle move from fifth to third in points as they run. And Biffle is third on the track. Carl Edwards has been as high as fifth. That's where he's running right now. Matt Kenseth started on the pole.
Had a tire problem. He's currently running in the seventh position. Jeremy.
Yeah. Kenseth benefited from a caution period, also a caution flag that really helped out.
Jeremy running 10th.
Yep. Mark Martin, the race leader.
Moved up a couple of positions.
Kurt Busch has fought his way back onto the lead lap after tire issues. He runs 21st. And here are the championship points as they run with 100 to go here at Kansas. 110 back to fifth place.
And Newman has not lost second position. He's back at 27th, but still hanging on to second. But we see 92 back, 92 points back. That's right. Not good.
You can see Kurt Busch, championship hopes starting to fade. Six to go after today.
Because he is running currently in the 20th position, and Tony Stewart running second.
Martin leads. And it's Stewart, Biffle, Schrader, and Edwards.
Coming in, I gotta come in. It's got really tight, and it's starting to shake it worse each straight away.
Ryan Newman.
Bring it in, guys. Four tires of steel.
Ryan Newman, currently 27th on the track, one of the 10 drivers in the chase for the championship. We are closing in on green flag pit stops. Mark Martin leads by 9/10 of a second over Tony Stewart. Here comes Ryan Newman to pit road, former winner here at Kansas. He has to go 45 miles an hour, 3/4 of the way down pit road, and he's heading for Matt Yoakum.
Seems like it'll take him forever to get down to his pit stall, but he came on the radio, Bill, back on lap 173, and said, I feel like the vibration that I've picked up is starting to get worse and worse. I think we may need to pit. Borland said, all right, bring it to us, and we will go for a four-tire change. He said he was trying to drag, joking around the left front, down on the apron just to pick up some grip to help the car. This team, not the day they'd hoped for, but boy, they sure have not given up. A little clean of the grill, and he is down and away.
So Ryan Newman avoided trouble in the big ones at Talladega last week, but did get caught up in an early crash here. And Brandon Ash spun. So that will drop him even deeper in the field.
It won't be long, I don't think, until the leaders will start making their pit stop.
Right, but the flip side of that is eight of the guys in the chase for the championship are running in the top nine on the track. Here comes Jimmy Johnson heading for pit road. Gives up the sixth position on the track, and he has to go all the way down pit road at 45 miles an hour. And he's heading for Alan Bestwick. He's all alone down there, AB.
Well, Bill, Jimmy's using a word you don't hear used often to describe the handling of a race car. Eggshells. He says he feels like he's driving on eggshells in the corner, being very, very careful with the corrections he makes on the wheel. That said, to be running in the top 10 at this point in the race, that's pretty good. They'll make a four-tire change and try and help his handling here, also wanting to make sure they get this car very full of fuel.
The Chad Canals led crew going to work on that car. A little longer stop than they'd want. Over 16 seconds, Johnson heads back out. Jeff Gordon is on pit road. Sterling Marlin, Jamie McMurray all making their stops under the green here at Kansas, Matt.
Bill, the car for Gordon still loose on entry, and then he says it just goes big time to the tight side. Going to make wholesale changes, both wedge and track bar adjustment. They made a track bar adjustment on the last two stops to try to fix it. Haven't got there yet. Today, Burns.
Leader Mark Martin in. Can he hold the lead through this round of pit stops? Four tire change, no changes to the chassis, no air pressure adjustments. Mark likes the way the car's been handling out front. He needs to get it back out. He's gone.
Good pit stop.
Mike Bliss gave up a top five spot. The 97 of Kurt Busch on pit road.
They want to take the air pressure down 1 pound in the right rear. They're going to make a pound, or actually a wedge adjustment as well. This car is very, very tight. Will not turn. As for the 16 of Greg Biffle, he's coming in at this point too. They want to go up on the right side air pressure. They want to make a wedge adjustment as well. Marty.
Tony Stewart says we've got to tighten this thing up on the takeoff because it's just too loose at the beginning of the run. They make an air pressure adjustment to the left side tires, trying to do that, waiting on the left rear. Leaves pit road.
Stewart got five bonus points for leading a lap. So did Carl Edwards. Matt Kenseth is headed for his stop. Let's check with AB.
He called in on the radio a little while ago, Bill. Ken Schrader did. Said to his crew chief, David Hyder, have I told you lately that I love you? That's how happy he is with the way this car is running. Four tire change for Schrader. Matt Kenseth is also in front of him. Carl Edwards also on the pit road. Marty?
And Carl said, Alan, that the car just started to lose grip at the end of that run. He really liked it at the beginning of the run. Half pound, that left side tire just a little bit too loose, but he was very happy with the chassis. Said it could have been him that was causing the car to do that because he experimented with lines throughout most of that run. 16-4 on the stop, Alan.
Jeremy Mayfield will pit. They'll make a four-tire change. You also see the adjustment wrench going in the right rear window on the car. Jeremy talking about wanting some help with the rear end grip on this Dodge as he closes in on the finish. The story of the day for this team, they've struggled in a couple of the opening races of the chase. Get a good finish, get points. Marty?
On the last stop, the Miller Lite guys delivered a 13-1 stop for Rusty Wallace. We'll see how they do this time. Rusty said the car was just a little bit too tight. They add a pound to the right rear tire. They go up on the track bar, trying to loosen them up, especially at the end of the run for Rusty Wallace. Last week at Talladega, the first time in 18 races, he didn't finish on the lead lap. And another great stop for those guys, 14-1.
And Rusty also did get 5 bonus points for leading a lap. Travis Quappel scored as the race leader. He will give that up and head for his pit stall. Bobby Labonte comes down pit road behind him. Dave?
And Travis has had a pretty decent car all day. Mostly tight, means it won't turn. They'll make, here's a chassis adjustment as well, working on that still. Four tire change for Travis. Those Penske cars always getting good mileage. Restarted the last time in 20th. We'll leave and get back on the track. Matt?
And Bobby Labonte's in. Not the best day for the 18 team. We're fighting balance issues, going back and forth between both tight and loose. Just haven't been able to hit that money spot. Luck's on the left side, and he is away.
Tell you what, that was a great stop by the Travis Quappel team. 13 seconds.
Jeff Burton comes down pit road. He gives up the lead. That means it is cycled back to Mark Martin. Of 267 laps on the board here at Kansas. Mark Martin leads. And Matt Kenseth has led the most laps today, and Mark is closing in on that. There are little Debbie lap leaders. 7 of the 10 chasers have led today.
Mark only needs about 5 more laps, and then he will have led the most laps today so far.
You lead the most laps, 5 more bonus points.
And a battle for second position. Biffle running in third has caught Tony Stewart. Goes by. Now we have 2 Roush-Kateers in the first 2 spots.
Chasers run 1st through 6th. Martin, Stewart, Biffle, Johnson, Edwards, Matt Kenseth. Rusty Wallace is 8th. Jeremy Mayfield 13th. Kurt Busch 16th. And Newman back in 23rd. Laps. Now 195 are complete. Mark Martin has led 69 of them, the most laps Martin has led in a race this year. So Mark chasing the checkered flag, chasing the championship, everybody else chasing him at the Kansas Speedway. Live at the Kansas Speedway, and this race is just zipping along. And so is Mark Martin, trying to put the 12 a lap down.
That 12 doesn't want to go a lap down.
Keep an eye on this battle. Here's our team Tylenol safety fact. 12 safety vehicles and 82 trained technicians are stationed around the Kansas Speedway during the race. 50 are firefighters on pit road, and those guys are on their toes every minute of the race.
That's an impressive number.
Mark needs to get this done. Quit messing around, because while he's running side by side with Newman, Stewart is gaining a lot of ground.
And Stewart has taken that second spot back over.
And they've swapped that a couple of times, BP.
Yeah.
Tony Stewart and Greg Biffle. All right. Mark has put Ryan Newman a lap down, so let's go through the field. Starting with Dave Burns.
Bell. Mark Martin running out front and dominating. Has not done that all season. In no race this season has Mark led the most laps. So far he has. We'll see if he can hang on to it. Marty.
Well, Dave, on the pit stop, we told you Tony Stewart wanted the looseness out of his number 20 Home Depot car. And they got the looseness out. Problem is they made the car way too tight now for Tony. He momentarily lost second. Car's coming back around, though, and he is running some good times, Dave.
You hear the guys in the booth mention Greg Biffle had passed for second around Tony Stewart. Lost that position again, but car operating pretty well for Greg. Alan?
Well, we talked at the top of the show about Jimmy Johnson looking for a good finish today to put Talladega behind them. They keep chipping away at it. This is as far to the front as the 48 car has run all day. Johnson up to fourth as the finish begins to be in sight.
Marty? Sixth place in the championship, fifth place on the racetrack. Carl Edwards has been getting better the longer this race has gone. He radioed to the crew, just for your notes, this setup would be too loose for a short run at the end of the race. Right now, the car handling very well, a little on the loose side. Alan?
Matt Kenseth running in sixth position now, trying to play catch-up. Remember, they had the problem earlier in the race with the vibration where they went from the lead all the way back into seventh spot, and they really haven't gotten any farther ahead since then. Marty?
Casey Mears ran well here last year, running well again here at Kansas. Said the car's a little too loose. He said, hey, they told him to hang on to it and just hang on to the race car right now. It gets tight the longer he runs. Rusty Wallace has had no complaints during this run. He's had three top tens in his last four races on the last pit stop. Car was too tight. They went up on the track bar, Matt.
Ricky Rudd really starting to get out of roll here. Just jumped up to the ninth position. He says the car just will not take off on the get-go. He loses too much time. The car is tight. No grip, but he is moving back toward the front, Alan.
Well, no loving adoration on the radio this second of the race from Ken Schrader to his crew chief, David Hyder, but still a very solid day so far. Schrader running in 10th position, been in the top 10 about all day, and would only be their fourth such finish this year. Marty?
I'm sorry, Matt.
Jeff Gordon just outside the top 10, AB running in 11th now. He just told Steve Letarte, we're making some headway, but not as fast as we need to. The car, once it lands in the corner, it takes a set. It just goes way too tight. He has to wait for it before he can get back into gas. Snyder?
Well, Mike Bliss did a good job on that two-tire stop earlier of holding on to track position. This time under green, obviously, they did take four tires. Car's been a little bit loose, but they've had a pretty good race car all day long. Alan?
After running in the top 10 about the entire race, Jeremy Mayfield suddenly finds himself outside of that group. They had a tough pit stop under the green flag. It's dropped him back to 13. Elliott Sadler back up to 14th. Remember, he started on the outside of the front row, slid way back, struggling with the handling of the new car. They seem to have hit on something this run. He's working his way back toward the top 10.
Marty? Alan, for most of the early part of this race, Sterling Marlin had a loose race car. Now the race car has gone tight. He said it feels like the left front of the left front tire is just ragged, not hanging in the racetrack like it should. Alan?
Brian Vickers just called in on the radio to his crew chief, Lance McGrew, and said, our car is good. What we like to get now is some clean air up front. What can we do to get track position? Well, that kind of depends how many yellows we see, Dave.
Kurt Busch still trying to bounce back from that flat tire on lap 77. Has not gained any position since the last pit stop. Bill?
Thanks, Dave. And there is a report that NASCAR is watching the 97 for a right front tire rub.
Well, we saw that tire smoke before he made that unscheduled stop early on in the race. About right there, you see, that's exactly what we saw when he made that unscheduled stop before.
We'll keep an eye on Kurt. Trouble breaks out, we'll break in. Mark Martin leads at Kansas.
Caution flag is out.
Michael letting everybody know he's a little slow. And waving to his fans.
I think he's waving to the TV audience because he knew that the TV camera would be on him after he blew up.
Well, he waited till we got back from commercial and the Wrangler five-star finish as well.
Good planning, Mikey.
217 laps are complete. And they can go the distance from here, Benny, you think?
Oh, yes, 50 50? Laps. Oh, okay. Sure they can.
Okay. So this might be your last shot to make your car better.
Michael coming off second corner and all of a sudden just explodes.
Day over. Jeff Burton is the car on the inside.
And Marcus in. Jeff, come on, give me a break. Let me have the inside. Okay.
Whoa, Mark, loose.
He just kind of took the inside. Might have been slight contact.
Those are two drivers that race with tremendous respect. Mark Martin and Jeff Burton. They race you the way you race them. Tony Stewart in the 20, then Biffle. Stewart inside of Burton for now sets his sights on Mark.
And Carl Edwards back there in the 99 trying to get through the traffic of Bobby Labonte and Dave Blaney.
Labonte and Blaney are not on the lead lap. 07 and 18. There's Vickers, who took two tires.
On the inside of Carl Edwards for position. And now Matt Kenseth on the inside of Carl Edwards. They're trying to make it three wide. Yikes!
Is that smoke coming out of the engine of the 18 car?
No, that was brakes, I'm pretty sure.
Because I saw it happen a lap earlier.
He's slow. He's in the wall. Bobby Labonte in the wall.
You're right, Wally.
Caution is out.
I saw that smoke on the restart, and I thought maybe he had an engine or some problem.
Now, we've got to figure out who gets the lucky dog, because Blaney and Jeff Burton are not sure who that is.
Let's go back and see if we can take a look at this.
Pretty good contact with the wall. I saw the smoke. I thought he'd hit the brakes when he got in the middle of that three-car lineup going down in turn one.
I saw smoke coming off of turn two in the restart. That's why I wasn't sure.
On board with Bobby.
See the smoke already?
Yeah.
I see that. Oh, no.
Been a disappointing season for Bobby Labonte. Disappointing day. Dave Blaney is a lucky dog. Mark Martin is the race leader, coming to get the green. 40 to go at Kansas. Got around Burton with no problem that time.
But Tony Stewart is hung up behind Jeff Burton.
He's going to get the 31 loose. Get him out of the way.
I'm not going to be hung up back there for long.
No.
Because they've seen how quick Mark gets away on these restarts.
There's Biffle trying to get on the high side of Burton. Yeah, these guys really have to clear these slower cars quickly, because when Mark's out front, he's in that clean air, and he's going to be flicking off some really fast times. So Biffle's got to go.
And Martin was strong on two tires. Last time he got four.
And there comes Vickers on the inside of Jeff Green. Trying to close in on the back of Greg Biffle.
Matt Kenseth in the 17, Carl Edwards, 99. Vickers with just two tires on his most recent stop.
I'll tell you, these NEXTEL Cup cars are so close anymore. If you give someone an advantage of a second or so, it's very difficult to catch them.
Brian Vickers runs fourth, Alan.
And Bill, what's the one thing Brian Vickers has not done in NEXTEL Cup racing yet?
Win.
You got it. He sniffs the front of the pack in the final laps of these races. He is up on the wheel. His crew chief, Lance McGrew, encouraging him. He wants to see if he can get up there and maybe catch a break.
Wants to taste the bacon.
Yeah, so I thought it was champagne in victory lane.
And I tell you what, behind this group, we got a group of cars that are trying their best to wreck. There they are. Man, they're pushing, shoving, gouging, anything they can do to get a position.
This is seventh on back. The 43 is not a lead lap car.
43 is. In the marbles, and in the wall.
Yep. We stay green.
Like I said, they're trying their best to wreck. Barr's finally did. Rusty Wallace on this side of Jimmy Johnson. That couldn't quite make it.
I'm telling you what. Casey Mears moving down on Ricky Rudd, and Ricky Rudd jumped out of the throttle. It was a good thing, because that would have been a wreck.
Ricky Rudd's got another run on Casey Mears. He's got position this time.
And Rusty trying to get past the 22 of Wimmer. Mears in the 41, Rudd in the 21, and Kurt Busch coming behind him with a little bit of help.
Kyle Petty, that 45 car, another great run for Kyle.
Kyle has a lap down in that bunch.
Mm-hmm. Yes. He and Wimmer both are a lap down.
So it's that 43 of Jeff Green, but he's hanging tough.
Well, after everybody makes a pit stop and puts four tires on, everybody's car stays pretty equal for the first 10 or 15 laps on tires.
So would you say at the beginning of the race for the next five or a mile and a half tracks?
Yes.
I mean, look at this. We got seven chasers in the top eight.
Yeah, it looks like we have a lot of good cookie cutter
packages.
Yep.
There's a lot of everybody in the chase is running really good on this racetrack.
Well, this track has earned a reputation for fantastic finishes. Very close. We'll see what happens. Tony Stewart chasing Mark Martin with 34 to go at Kansas. Working lap 240 of 267 at the Kansas Speedway, and that man, veteran Mark Martin, with 34 career wins, out front by 1 second over Greg Biffle. Tony Stewart runs third, then it's Brian Vickers and Matt Kenseth.
And Vickers just lost that spot to Carl Edwards. Here we see Biffle coming off turn four. Biffle in almost making contact. And Biffle takes that spot away.
Mark leads. Here is our Napa field summary. There have been 12 leaders. Martin has led 112 laps. He has clinched the five bonus points for leading the most laps today. Bobby Labonte, Michael Waltrip, PJ Jones, Brandon Ash, and Bobby Hamilton Jr., the five cars out of the race. We're going to take our last green flag pit stop, then come back to Kansas and take you to the checkered flag. You're watching NASCAR on NBC. 20 laps to go in the Banquet 400 at the Kansas Speedway in Kansas City. Mark Martin has led 119 laps, but his lead is shrinking in a hurry. Now 0.4 seconds over Greg Biffle. And Biffle is charging. Look at that.
Mark needs to flip the mirror. Don't even look in it.
Those Roush cars are looking forward to your cookie cutter tracks.
Well, they run so well on this type of racetrack too, Bill. But you know, every Kansas race has had a margin of victory under 1 second. It looks like the same thing going to happen again today.
Biffle was a little bit quicker than Mark that last lap, so he's slowly gaining.
Tony Stewart is going to have some competition for that third spot in a few laps. Carl Edwards is gaining on him a little bit each lap.
Okay, we're going to keep an eye on the lead and watch the battle for third, but we do want to get you a top 10 through the field with 18 to go. Dave?
Mark Martin has won 34 races in his NEXTEL Cup career. None this year, none in the chase. This would be the perfect time. He entered the chase in sixth. He needs to try to make a move today, currently in the ninth position in the chase. Right behind him, Greg Biffle trying to run him down. He passed Tony Stewart, had a great restart, has run very well this final run trying to take the lead. Marty.
Tony Stewart trying to extend his championship lead today. I just talked to Greg Zippidelli. I asked him about the volts, and he showed me the cross finger sign, keeping his fingers crossed that the volts hold up on the car. A little bit too tight chassis-wise for the car right now. Carl Edwards is having a terrific run here late in the race. His spotter just told him, you look better than anyone on the racetrack right now. It's time to get aggressive and go get him, Alan.
Remember that Brian Vickers took just two tires on his final pit stop for track position. His team calling out his lap times, trying to encourage him to get everything he can in these final laps. He's hanging on. On the other side of the coin, Matt Kenseth has said nothing on his radio, but he has slipped back. He was in front of a couple of these cars that are now ahead of him a little while ago. So Kenseth, who dominated the race earlier, hanging in sixth. As for Jimmy Johnson, the goal for today was to have a problem-free race and a top finish. They're in line to do that, although they have given up a couple of spots here in this last run of the race. Marty?
Another very solid day for Rusty Wallace, who's recovered from the problem on pit road earlier. The car has been tight for much of the second half of the race. He is up in the eighth position right now. Casey Mears said the car is about as tight as it's been all day long. He's going for a second top 10 in three races, trying to hang on in the top 10 right now, currently in ninth. Dave?
Kurt Busch restarted in the 13th position, currently running 10th, has picked up three spots, has not said much on the radio about his car. A little smoke going into the turns. It's probably just a small tire rub.
And Carl Edwards is there right behind Tony Stewart.
Carl's using that high line. Seems to be working for him, BP. He's getting a lot of speed off of turn four.
In front of this, Mark Martin has stretched it out to half a second over Greg Biffle with 15 to go. This is the battle for third. Stewart, the championship leader. And Carl Edwards, another driver in the chase for the NEXTEL Cup.
Boy, he's got that high line working for him. He's got a little momentum, but...
Tony comes off that corner, moves up and blocks him and stops his momentum.
Marty, you got something on this?
Yeah, when I was talking about Casey Mears a second ago and paused, I was listening to Carl Edwards saying, I'm catching him, and I can get him. There's still time.
And he can. He's on the inside.
Yeah, Stewart drove in real deep into turn three that time, and his car slid up the racetrack. That's all Edwards needed to do was to fill the gap.
And Carl goes back to his favorite spot high on the racetrack.
Roush cars run 1-2-3 at Kansas.
And Carl gave Tony the big wave. Thanks, buddy. Now Matt Kenseth has caught Brian Vickers in that 25. It's a battle for fifth, and it's 5 points. More than the battle for fifth, it's 5 points for Kenseth.
You can look at the points as they run. 12 to go at Kansas. Then six races after this one in the chase for the NEXTEL Cup. Greg Biffle was fastest last time by, but only by 5/100ths of a second.
Vickers slides up the track a little bit. See if Kenseth can keep the car below him, going into turn one, side by side down the straightaway.
And remember, Vickers only changed two right side tires on that last pit stop. He might be seeing the ill effects of that. Nevertheless, a great run for the Vickers car today.
That's Jimmy Johnson right behind him, too.
Back up front, Mark Martin. By 3/10 of a second. Last time by over Biffle. They go by the scoring stripe again. Lead is half a second, Dave.
And about seven laps ago, Greg Biffle said, I'm not sure I can do it. Very loose race car. I just about wrecked trying to catch the six.
You never know how good Mark Martin's car is until the end of the race, because he's an excellent driver at saving his equipment until he really needs it.
Well, he needs it right now.
He sure does.
And he's using every ounce of equipment he has to try to stay in front of that 16 car.
Holds the wheel with his hands, but drives with his heart, Mark does. Speeds at the line.
Carl Edwards, a little quicker than the first two cars.
Jimmy Johnson has gotten around Brian Vickers. Five big points for Johnson in that 48, and Rusty Wallace wants by.
I think he's going to get by. This is where the two tire guys start really sliding off, and guys who change four tires, this is the part of the run that really shines for him.
Boy, and that two team battling back from a broken jack. A lot of teams really fought back from some trouble today.
Two tires.
Had a strong run.
He sure has. And Casey Mears, that 41 car. The last half of the race, he has been extremely strong. Back in ninth position.
Marty?
And Jimmy Ellis is trying to encourage Casey that you can get by the 25 car. Casey says, oh, I don't know how this car's so tight. I can barely drive it right now.
But Casey's still looking at a top 10 finish if he can hang on.
Mark Martin goes by, completes another lap. Six more to go.
And car six leads with six to go. his teammate Biffle chasing him.
Biffle goes, drives it down the corner, and just, it's so loose he can't turn the hood, kind of let it drift up the racetrack.
And Mark is going to get it. I think the only way Biffle can get to him is if Mark gets hung up on some of these slower cars he's coming up on right now. It's and only going to take a little bit.
That Trison and company. 5 to go for him, Dave.
And speaking traffic, Wally, almost to the car, they're saying get the X out of the way, get the Y out of the way. Whatever car's in front of them, get them out of the way. Talking to the spotter.
Yeah, you when you come up on these slower cars, you want to make sure that they know you're coming or you're the leader. Give plenty of room.
Last week, Mark out of the race early at Talladega. You could hear the disappointment in his voice. You could see it in his face. This was going to be his last season.
All together, get him out of the way. Four more.
Yeah, what he doesn't want these guys in front of him to start racing side by side. That'd really be trouble for him.
Well, that'd be
Mark.
That's Kevin LePage. Oh, I thought Mark was around the wall. Kevin LePage.
LePage pulls down.
Let's him go by.
Car owner Jack Roush looking on. Biffle picked up some, a little bit of ground there. For Mark Martin, he will have to get by Mike Wallace.
I think Mike Wallace already pointed out the window to go low.
Wallace in the four car, drifts up the hill. Mark gets him on the back stretch. Biffle trying to close in. 2.5 laps to go. Labeled this season the salute to you tour, the salute to the fans. This was going to be Mark's last season, his last full-time season in the NEXTEL Cup Series. Right now has plans to return next year because Jack Roush needs him in that car.
And Jack Roush has got to be an extremely happy man. Three cars, three Roush cars running. One, two, three.
He's not happy yet.
Oh, that's true, because it's not over.
Last lap at Kansas.
There's the cat in the hat.
I think Mark's got plenty of buffer right now between him and Biffle.
Looking to get by Dale Jarrett.
And Jarrett does move over. Let Mark go. 6/10 of a second back to Biffle. I don't think Greg can catch him.
Last week we asked Mark about his 34 wins, what the next one would mean. He said he really didn't care about the next race win. He just wanted the championship. But he's going to get the win. Win number 35 for Mark Martin.
I tell you, that two-tire stop that he made back in the race to get that track position up there, and once he got that position, the crew, what a job they did to hold that position all day long.
52 races without a win for Mark Martin. That string ends. His first win since Dover in June of 2004, and the first win for Ford at Kansas. Came from 19th.
And Mark is old school. And we salute you, Mark, from the fans. There you go. He will not be doing any burnouts.
Rusty Wallace, it is his last season. Wallace seventh, waves to his friend. A couple of veterans, another one, Ricky Rudd. Top 10 finish for Rudd. Mark Martin says, as Benny talked about, the burnouts are for the kids. His job is to drive to victory lane. Dave Burns.
Getting congratulations from guys at pit road. I saw you sit back like you just been in a war out there.
It was pretty stressful those last few laps with Viagra. Four tires has been awesome all day, and Mark just did a phenomenal job holding Greg off because Greg was awesome, and it's nice to get that 1-2. I think we got a 1-2-3, so that's just pretty awesome for Jack today, and hopefully it gets a little closer to that chase. We just got to keep making up points.
Three of the top five, Pat. Talk about this Roush dominance today.
We all had great cars. You know, we're still all working.
We're the top five.
We're all still working together just like we have been all year, and we're going to continue to do that, and hopefully we'll win some more races. We scored the most points we could today, so we'll just keep trying to make them up, win one race at a time.
How about this first win of the season for you guys?
Yeah, it's really our second, but first points were in, and couldn't come at a better time. It was one of the tracks we were worried about, and to come out of here winning was pretty special for us.
A lot more tracks just like it coming up. The sixth team comes home victorious, Bill.
Thank you, David. 12th win for Jack Roush in 2005. Mark Martin pulls into victory lane. When we come back to Kansas, we'll take you there. Celebrate with Jack Roush, Mark Martin, and the rest of the guys at Kansas. Mark Martin has won the Banquet 400. Let's go to victory lane, and here's Alan Bestwick.
And here is Mark Martin. He won the All-Star race earlier this year, but this is his first win in a points-paying race this year. Mark, congratulations.
Man, I just want to say, Matt and Arlene, I wish you guys were here. It's a really special day for me. I want to thank all the fans for the great support I've had this year. And Pat Tryson and the Viagra team, this Ford was incredible today. It reminded me of the old days in a Busch car. It was just awesome. These guys want to win so bad, and they believe in me. And they made a winner out of an old man today.
I think they'll argue with the old man part of that. Mark, you had a lead on Greg Biffle. He was gaining on you, and then you seemed to stabilize that lead. Did you pull up a little reserve, or how did that stabilize?
I don't want to lose. I always tell these guys, you give me the lead, four fresh tires, with the end in sight, and you'll never get a fight like you get from me. And I had the race car to do it. I ran as hard as I could run there. In the beginning, maybe saved a little bit. And then when Greg started coming, I stepped it up. And, I could have drove maybe a little bit harder, but I might have wrecked. That's as fast as I could go and keep him behind me.
A thought on the championship, an important win for you today.
My thoughts on the championship are they probably slipped out of our hands last week. But winning's great. Leading the most laps and winning, probably puts us back close. But, it's going to be a lot harder now than it was going to be if we could have finished in the top 10 at Talladega.
You're seventh now, 113 points from the lead.
Yeah, that's too far back. But we can go into some more, and you never know. The thing is these guys are my heroes. They're the ones that put me in this chase. They kept it together and kept working hard, and they're a championship team, and they deserve to be in the chase. We made the chase, and unfortunately, we had some trouble, big trouble at Talladega, and it may be impossible to dig out of, but I'll love them forever for what they've done for me.
Well, I guarantee they haven't given up on it yet. Mark Martin, the winner today here in Kansas. Today, Burns.
With second place finisher, his teammate Greg Biffle. And Mark just spoke about nearly wrecking, trying to stay in front of you. What were you seeing?
I was just hounding him like a cat, ready to pounce on him, trying to put enough pressure on him to get him to make a mistake, I saw him sideways a couple times, but it's really hard to get Mark Martin to make a mistake. I could tell you that. He's a great driver, and those guys were on it. They made adjustments on their car and got better. And, I was driving the wheels off that thing. It's just all I had. He was beating me bad down here in 3 and 4. I could get him pretty good in 1 and 2 and get close enough, but he beat me so bad in 3 and 4 I couldn't do anything with him. But it was a tough run, It's I want to say happy birthday to my brother. His birthday this weekend, and just a great run for us overall. We wanted to gain more points than we did, but we're happy with it.
On the radio, you spoke of wrecking yourself. How on the edge was your car?
I nearly wrecked down there in 3 and 4. I tried the top. Joel, my spotter, told me that the guys were using the top, and I took a little bit more wedge out of it that last time, and I drove in the top there, and the thing just started going sideways. I barely saved it. So I just stuck to the bottom and knew at that point I probably wasn't going to get him unless he made a big mistake. And he almost got the wall coming off of two over there, but he did a great job. And my team did a good job in the pits, and just happy to bring the guard car home second.
And so how about this now? A few tracks coming up that look a lot like this, Greg.
Yeah, we're excited about that. We can't wait. But the problem is finishing second with Tony finishing fourth doesn't gain us a lot of points. And that's what we need to do. We need to not have him have bad luck, but just have better runs. I guess there's only one spot better we can get. But, it's hard to gain on 10 points at a time.
Titans up for Biffle, getting closer to the lead. Has to beat the 20 car to do it. Marty Snyder.
And Dave Carl Edwards told his crew after the race, you gave me the car to win, but the last restart just killed us. What did you mean by that?
Well, I just I wasn't patient enough. You know, I think we were fourth, and I went in the corner, and I thought, I'm going to pass some of these guys on the outside. And I lost two spots, and I sure needed two spots at the end. So the car was fast enough, Office Depot, Ford, you know, everybody that helped out to build this new car. Intel was on board, and they gave me the car. I mean, it was there. It's just that it's so precise here. You have to be perfect, you know?
I heard you screaming on the radio. You were trying to catch Tony there, and you thought for a while you weren't going to be able to get him.
Yeah, I was trying real hard, and I think he was going to let me go. Tony was going to let me go by, and then he thought to himself, well, there's 12 laps to go, and I'm going to race him real hard. So we had a pretty good race there. It was a blast racing with him, and I got by him, and I kind of gave him, you know, like, hey, good job out the window, and he waved to me, and we went on. But, hey, congratulations to Mark Martin and Greg Biffle. I mean, a 1-2-3 Roush Racing Day is cool, but I got to be honest, I really wanted to win this race here today. I mean, that's what I came here to do, and I'm going to do whatever I can to win a race at Kansas someday.
Does this give you a picture of how hard it's going to be to win the championship with Tony finishing the way he's finishing?
Yeah, how about that, you know? I go out there, we have a brand new car, everything's perfect, run as well as I can, and Tony Stewart finishes one spot behind me, so we're just going to notch little bits, but it's still a good day. Anytime you make up ground on the leader, it's good. Anything can happen. I mean, you know, anything can happen.
And Dave Burns is with our championship leader, Tony Stewart.
Yep, just catching up to Tony right now. He's made his way back to the Holler Smoke. You're in the championship lead as it is, 75 points out, fourth place finish. Everybody's saying, you know, we did great today, but Stewart finished right up there with us.
Yeah, not too bad for a car that was just a little off. I mean, we had a setback in the practice session the other day, and it got us off a little bit, but guys rebounded really well. We just we threw an alternator belt early, and that made us have to turn all the electrical switches off, all the brake fans, the fans that blow cool air on the bead of the tires to keep the tires cool. It hurt us because it lets it build air pressure a little quicker. So, you know, late in the run there when guys were getting their cars a little better, it was hard for us to keep up with them. But, you know, to have a bad day like that and end up in the top four, really really excited and proud of the Home Depot team.
Your teammate Bobby Labonte had a little trouble. Did they radio some information that might have related to that alternator situation?
They didn't say anything to me. I mean, I'm sure they were in communication with Greg and everything. But, you know, what always happens with one team car doesn't always happen with the other. But today it happened with both of us. So I don't know if it happened with the 11 or not, but it was just one of those weird things today. We've had some alternator trouble in the past, but you know, here recently we've had it under control. I thought we were back to having a problem again, but it was kind of comforting knowing we just threw a belt today. So if that's the worst of it, we got it made.
Smoke, radio communication we heard today talked about, guys, if we keep doing it this way, I don't know if it was you talking, but it's ours. As a championship, you're pretty confident about where you guys are right now?
Well, if we can keep running in the top five like this, I mean, that's what we need to do. So, you know, like I've always told people, I mean, there's no guarantees, and you know, everybody's wanting to talk points every week, but the easiest way to put it in perspective, I mean, we aren't even halfway through the schedule here in the last 10 weeks, so it'd be like week 16 of a 36-week schedule talking about points, so we got a long way to go yet. So, you know, as much as we want to talk about it right now, the biggest thing is just worrying about making sure that we focus and that we're focusing on doing the things to keep us in the top five each week, and, you know, with a week or two to go, then we'll worry about the point standings.
And Charlotte next week, a track where he definitely could finish in the top five. Marty?
Rally, the word of the day for Matt Kenseth, and a nice recovery. You surprised you could finish in the top five after the problems you had early, Matt?
Well, yes and no. We just sort of missed it. I was kind of surprised. We had a really good car in practice on Friday, but the track changes quite a bit, and after that first run when we fell back, just really fought a car, just couldn't really get it to turn very good, so just had great pit stops. Without our pit stops, we probably would have ran 15th or so. So I got to give it to them guys. They get me out up front every week, and did a good job recovering.
A terrific performance for Roush Racing as a whole today with four in the top five.
Yeah, the stuff's awesome right now. I just wish I wouldn't get beat by my teammates all the time. But if you're going to get beat by somebody, it's good to get beat by them guys. So that was awesome to see Mark win. You know, he hasn't had a win in a while. Won an all-star race, but hasn't had a win in a while before that. So that's awesome to see him there in victory lane. And overall, it was a great day for us.
You were saying midway through the race, in essence, we can't give away points. I know guys wanted to come up there and try and lead a lap. Is this in a position now where you have to every man for themselves, basically?
Well, I mean, yes and no. I mean, I think the 97's mad, but we help each other a lot. You know, I've helped the 97 a lot through the years. He's helped me a lot through the years. Kurt's helped me a lot, and Greg and everybody. But when you get in the chase, I mean, you got to get all the points you can. I mean, there's a 97, and there's a whole bunch of them lined up behind him that haven't led yet that were in the chase, too. And, you know, it'd be pretty stupid to give somebody a free 5 points and lose the championship by four at the end of the year. So right now it looks like we're ways out of it. But, you know, Jimmy Johnson went out there last year, made up a ton of points, and you just got to be smart about it. I mean, you got to race. I mean, there comes a time where you got to race, and that's just all there is to it.
The 20 car looked awfully strong, but encouraging in all that you've done
done so well at these mile and a half racetracks, as all of Roush has, and you've got a lot of these racetracks coming up.
Well, the encouraging part for me is that we've been running a lot better. We have three top fives in Chase. We're running a top five at Dover and when we blew our second tire, and we've had some problems and still been able to finish good. So even though we're ways behind, the other guys that aren't behind, haven't had any problems yet. And we're going to some tracks like Charlotte and stuff that's kind of an unknown, and I feel good about our performance. I just feel like if you can run in the top five and even in the top 10 every week, you're going to be there then.
17 team finishes fifth today. Matt?
Jimmy Johnson, a strong top 10 finish. The car get tight at the end, Jimmy?
Yeah, it did. It looks like I hit some... I know I straddled a piece of rubber that was on the track and it caved in the valance, and that hurt us a little bit. All day long, we were really loose, and then that last run, the car got tied. But still, great performance. We didn't qualify like we wanted to, but the Lowe's team worked really hard, made some great adjustments all day long, good pit stops, and we did what we needed to do. It looks like everybody in the chase is going to be winning races, and it's about being in the top five, top 10 week after week, and so far, so good.
Does it make everybody have to take it up a notch that you're just not going to be able to back into it?
I think in a race or two, that mindset will start to come in. Right now, at least from my perspective, I'm just trying to feel it out, see who has problems, who's fast, who's where, and really where we are at the end of it. Right now, we're behind a little bit, so we're going to have to get to work and get a couple Ws and see if we can get the slowest car back in victory lane and get a lot of points.
Now, next week, we go back to your house, the Lowe's Motor Speedway, where you started off last year a three-race win streak.
Yeah, it's been a great track for us. Obviously, it's changed a lot. I was there in the Busch car and had a great test with the Busch team. And so at least I've got an idea what to expect, and hopefully we have that magic back. It's not the same track that it was years ago or even in the spring. It's still going to be different. I think everybody's going to be adjusting to it.
Jimmy Johnson, top 10 here at Kansas.
All right, Matt, thanks a lot. Now here are the championship standings with six races to go in the chase for the NEXTEL Cup. Championship chasers finished in the top seven spots today. And while Tony leads by 75, it's just 41 points from second place Ryan Newman back to eighth place Matt Kenseth. Jeremy Mayfield hanging on, Kurt Busch with a lot of work to do. A short time ago, Matt Yoakum spoke with Rusty Wallace.
Rusty Wallace comes home seventh place. Now, are you going to have to step it up and go for a W the way this chase is starting to lay out?
Yeah, I saw the Roush was 1-2-3 out there, and I thought I really had a good car myself. But seventh, I tell you what, I handled good all day long, got a little tight, but that just shows how good those top seven cars were, man. Us top seven today were really, really strong, and it was really hard to pass them. I was catching Jimmy just a little bit right there at the end, and then I'd give up a little bit, then I'd catch him again, but... it was a good solid day coming from where I qualified. I qualified really poorly, 33rd, and drove it right up there to 8th, and then we broke a jack. Had to go back to the back again, got back up to the front. But all in all, the same stuff we've been doing all year long, good solid runs. And I want to thank my team and the engine shop and all the guys, Miller Lite. We had a great day today. I don't know where we are in the points yet, but I'm sure it's still all bunched up pretty good.
How much of a hindrance was the lap cars near the end?
They were really, really tough to get around outside of, and a lot of them are real, real aggressive, and boy, there's nothing wrong with it, but you could really tell the ones going for the lucky dog, and boy, you see some guys driving a real nice, pretty lap, and all of a sudden, the next time you see them going wide open, and you can tell that lucky dog is what they're after, and that really screws you up when you're trying to do what we're doing, is trying to win a championship, because it's been several laps to get around them, and then once we got around them, the leaders were gone. But hey, I'd be doing the same thing, man. It's just all in racing, and that's what we do and love.
Now, unofficially, you're fourth in the standings, 90 markers out of first. Now, do you sit down and start looking at the remaining races and look at where you are expected to have big points days and where you're going to have to try to pick it up?
Well, I'm expected to have a good, really good points day at Martinsville. I think I can have a good points day at Charlotte. I really do. And yeah, honestly, Matt, all the rest of these racetracks I'm going to, I like them all. Whether it's Phoenix or Texas or Martinsville, I think they're all good tracks for the two crew. And I feel confident going to rest of them. Yeah, I don't like being 90 points behind, and the Talladega thing is what screwed that up. But or else we'd only be like 20 or something. But that was a bad deal, Talladega. It's hard to get over that one.
We did a poll during the race of whether a plate race should be in the chase. What's your vote? Obviously, coming off of what happened last week, obviously.
My vote is absolutely not. It shouldn't be in a race. Look, it's great for the fans. When it comes to the overall outcome of the car, there's too many things that can happen. Too many things can screw it up. There's too many good cars that Talladega's riding along only to get taken out, not by their own doing. And, I mean, like my car, I'm cruising along, and, we had a big crash in front of us, and I saw the 41 come across my bow, and they're all wrecking and flipping and turning it over, and I'm not big on that. But you know what? It doesn't make a difference because I'm going to be back, man. They can do what they want to do,
Rusty Wallace, seventh here in Kansas.
Jeff, 10th on the day. Wrap that up for us. How's that?
Real good compared to what we've been doing on these mile and a half. So, I mean, I got to be, you know, happy and you know, feel like we're headed in the right direction this weekend. We qualified well and we ran up front. We lost track position there one time on a restart and really got us way back there. And, you know, we were about a you know, 8th to 10th place car. So we finished 10th. Real happy with that process, you know, the progress that we made. And it's certainly not a top five or win where we need to be, but at least it's going in the right direction.
So that fade we saw sort of after a very strong start to this race, that was just getting behind cars, not having that air on the front of your car?
Yeah, I definitely noticed, you know, each position I got further back, you know, that we, you know, the car was very uncomfortable. So, you know, I know track position is extremely important. We wanted to maintain it. You know, there's one time we made a big adjustment because I was real tight at the end of the run, middle of the run to the end, and I got real loose at the beginning. And so I lost a couple positions there, and, you know, that wasn't too bad. We maintained that for a while. And then there was one time I chose the outside lane, and it seemed like every single lap car went to the outside lane, and, you know, we just got freight trained. So, you know, I'm just happy we had something consistent, had something that when we made adjustments, you know, I could get a good feel for it, had something to lean on for a change. And we're certainly not there where we need to be, but we're heading in the right direction. And, you know, I thought the communication was real good between Steve and myself. And, you know, we know we got some more things to work on, but for the most part, you know, good day for DuPont Chevrolet. Top 10 on a mile and a half. Thank you.
Jack, congratulations on a great day for your race teams. 1, 2, 3. How do you react to that?
Well, that's, you know, that's what we owed our sponsors, and we owed our fans our best effort. You know, they've invested heavily in us, and, you know, today this is one of the racetracks where we had been not successful at before, but it's a formula that we're pretty good at this year, and if we can't do it here, we can't do it.
Jack, one of the things we talked about on the air today was drivers on the same team and bonus points and what the protocol might be there. Do you have thoughts on your drivers' influence in whether or not they let a teammate by to lead and get bonus points when they're racing against each other for the title?
Well, there's no team orders, and they have the same prerogatives to either cooperate or not cooperate that they have with every other driver on the racetrack. So right now, anybody's in the chase. The impression I have from what they're doing, anybody's in the chase, you're going to race every lap with. For the most laps led, if you can keep somebody down a lap, they're going to do that. If you can keep somebody from leading lap, they're going to do that. They're racing against one another as hard as they're racing against anybody else that's on the racetrack.
Your team's strength on tracks of this size is being much discussed by everyone because they're winning races on these kind of tracks. What are your thoughts on why your team is so strong on this kind of racetrack?
When NASCAR cut the spoiler down an inch last year, they made the cars inherently loose. When Goodyear came out with a tire that complemented that, that also wound up creating a formula where the speed is in the car when it rotates with the back end, not with the steering wheel. Not every driver likes to drive cars like that. They don't feel as comfortable as when the back end is really settling, you turn it with the front wheels. It just happens that the template that Mark Martin brought to me and the template that Greg Biffle has developed for himself, that of Matt Kenseth, that of Kurt Busch, and that of Carl Edwards, all like to drive the cars the way these cars are fast. And there's some real winners and losers with this formula, the same as there would be with any other change that NASCAR might make. But right now, it's just fallen into our laps, and life is good.
Hey, look at that smile. I know you play no favorites, but how special is it to you at this point in your relationship to see Mark Martin winning races?
Well, I'd like to think that there's time for all of our drivers to win a championship throughout their career. You know, Kurt's had one, Matt's got one, Greg is certainly ready for his. There's one out there for Carl, and Mark is way past it.
Jack, thanks for the time. Congratulations.
Back here at the Kansas Speedway. Over 80,000 fans saw a good one, and they saw Mark Martin go to victory lane. Started with some pretty spectacular pre-race ceremonies, and then Matt Kenseth and Elliott Sadler took the field to the green flag. A little trouble early. Brandon Ash, contact with Dale Earnhardt Jr. Ryan Newman in the 12 car, up, pinched against the wall. His day was never the same, finished 23rd. Rusty Wallace on pit road under a caution flag. Broken jack. We heard him talk about it. Get the other jack. Get it under there. Get Rusty back out. Crew worked hard. Driver drove well. Rusty comes home 7th. Kurt Busch. Tire issues. Had to make an unscheduled stop. Recovered to finish 14th today.
but is 10th in the chase for the NEXTEL Cup. At 103, Stuart Kirby into the wall. That helped Busch and Newman get back on the lead lap, but they really could not capitalize on it this afternoon. Or said, one car spin, a lot of smoke. Sent the field to pit road. Mark Martin took two tires, came out in the lead. And Mark was pretty much the story after that. Bobby Labonte, very disappointing season. Another DNF for the 18 bunch. And then the final half mile, Mark Martin by half a second over Greg Biffle. Car owner Jack Roush celebrates. Career win number 35 for Mark. And here are the results from the Banquet 400.
And look at how all the chase guys, or a lot of the chase guys, ran so strong today here on this racetrack.
And led a lap.
Each one of those green lights on the right side indicate cars that led a lap. And Jeff Gordon did come back, he said, ran better today than they have been running on these type of racetracks.
Busch did not lead a lap today. Jeremy Mayfield did.
Busch is way back in the points. 220.
224, yeah.
So his chances are pretty much done.
There's Ryan Newman, 23rd on the track, second in the championship standings. We'll get to those.
See, Mike Wallace back in 35th. He, in fact, did lead one lap under the caution flag.
Disappointing run for Dale Jarrett off the win at Talladega. And those guys, not the finish they were hoping for. Six to go in the chase for the NEXTEL Cup. Check in with Matt.
Back in the garage area, Bill, NASCAR's inspection going over the 20 car. Now, Zippy, back in August, we were talking about as the chase was getting closer, you went to victory lane. You said, the big thing, though, for my guys, not to lose focus, even though we're on this great run. And it seems like they're still up on the chip, digging each week.
Yeah, we had a bad run at Dover. I think it was a little reality check for us all. We got us grounded after we left Loudon very disappointed that we didn't win. We went up there with all intentions, did everything we had to do, and instead of looking at it on the positive, saying we left there with the point lead again, led the most laps, sat on a pole, and had a really good shot of winning until we tore that fender up. But, we looked at it on the bad side, and we were disappointed. And we all sat and we talked about it and looked at it and said, the bottom line is, if we can run second, third, the rest of the year, we'll be fine. We'll win this championship. Last week we went back to Talladega, a place that we've run really well at, have seemed to be fall races have been good to us there with 5 second place finishes. So, we were kind of excited about going there where everybody else was worried. It just kind of, some things seemed like they were on our side, the year we won the championship, we gained the point lead back at Talladega. So just like we did this year. So, if you look back at stats, it gives us all those little things to encourage us and keep going. But Roush cars are going to be tough. We were off a little bit today. We just couldn't get it freed up enough in a late entry. But Tony did a great job. We lost an alternator belt, and that kind of threw us for a little bit of a scare. We had to switch batteries and weren't really sure if it would go the distance. So we were making phone calls back to the shop during the race on the studies that they did on the battery and how long it would last on just the ignition and all that stuff. But they were right on it. It made it. So that's the big thing.
The thing I thought about this morning when I woke up and it was near freezing conditions, Zippy's Crusade for Kids charity in January is big snowmobile ride, Dave.
Matt, this is Doug Richard. He is a crew chief for Greg Biffle. And Greg Zippidelli just said Roush cars are going to be tough. And something tells me between barbecue discussions today, you guys realize you've got a mile and a half program that's pretty good.
Yeah, well, I know the 16 and really all our Roush cars have been strong on the mile and a half and 2 miles. And, we put some of our best shows together for these last 10. But, this is a car we had at Charlotte. We slammed the wall pretty hard. And the guys did a lot of work, and it paid off. We didn't quite win, but we lost to one of our teammates. So we're keeping it in the house. But we're looking forward to the rest of the races this year. I feel like we have some strong races coming up to boot, and we just got to get through Martinsville. That's probably about the weakest thing that we got coming up.
Good day for Doug and his crew. Marty?
And not such a good day for our former champion, Kurt Busch. And you guys finished 14th. Jimmy Finning, what was going on with the right front issues?
Well, we just ran it pretty hard that time and hurt it. We were racing pretty hard against our teammate.
All right, and is it over, Jimmy?
No, I don't give up, and this team don't give up, so we're going to keep on plugging away.
He may be 10th in the championship standings, but our former champion not giving up yet, Bill.
Thanks, Marty. Thanks, you guys, for a great job down there today. Go ahead.
Next week, we go to Lowe's Motor Speedway. We heard the drivers talking about it. They have ground turns 1 and 2, or levigated, as Humpy Wheeler calls it. And Tony Stewart wrecked 2 cars. Greg Biffle wrecked 2 cars in practice. But it does seem to get better as time goes on, as you get rubber in the racetrack.
And 4 of the 5 starting today on mile-and-a-half tracks, and the Roush guys have got it.
I think they've got a great chance. But as BP said, I think Charlotte's kind of another wild card because of the pavement. Everybody is kind of worried about that race.
Huge win for Mark Martin. Chasers finished in the top 7 positions here in the Banquet 400 at the Kansas Speedway in Kansas City. And we'll be back here next year. 80,000 people plus on their way home. Jack Roush signing autographs in Victory Lane. Don't forget, next Saturday night, NASCAR hits primetime with NASCAR Nextel Cup Racing from the Lowe's Motor Speedway, presented by the Principal Financial Group at 7 Eastern, 4 Pacific. And coming up next, except on the West Coast, it's your local news. Then starting at 7, 6 Central, it's all new episodes of Dateline NBC, The West Wing, Law & Order, Criminal Intent, and Crossing Jordan. For Matt Yoakam, Dave Burns, Marty Snyder, Alan Bestwick, Wally Dellenbach, and the champ Benny Parsons, and our entire NBC race family, I'm Bill Weber. Thanks for having us in for the race. We'll see you next weekend from the Lowe's Motor Speedway in Charlotte. Mark Martin wins at Kansas.
Win number 35 for Mark Martin.